We're talking tonight with two special guests about the topic is the universe and the earth. Are they billions of years old or just thousands of years old? And are Genesis 1 and 2 compatible with contemporary scientific evidence today? My guests are Dr. Hugh Ross, who received his PhD in astronomy from the University of Toronto. He did his postdoctoral research on quasars at Caltech. Also, Dr. Kent Hovind, who received his PhD in education, writing his doctoral dissertation on the subject of creation and evolution. Guys, we're glad that you're here tonight. And we're going to start right off with an important question. And Dr. Ross, I'd like to start with you. The Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, you believe the scientific evidence for the Big Bang proves that this statement is true. But you also believe that the Big Bang theory shows that the age of the universe and the earth is billions of years old. And the scientific evidence astronomers have discovered about the Big Bang, it perfectly fits the biblical creation account in Genesis 1 and 2. Why? Talk to us.
Sure. Well, I'd like to give credit where it's due. I mean, a lot of people think Albert Einstein and George Gamow were the ones that discovered the Big Bang. But in truth, they were upstaged by 2,000 years by Moses and David and Zechariah, Jeremiah, Isaiah. Because what you see is eight times the Bible states that the universe was transcendently created, a transcendent beginning of matter, energy, space, and time, which is identical to the Big Bang concept of a singular beginning. And likewise, in 11 different places in the Bible, it tells us that the universe is continually experiencing ongoing expansion, you know, the stretching out of the heavens. It's in the cal active participle form, this continual stretching out. And the third point is that you have in Romans chapter 8 that the entire creation is subject to the law of decay. And that implies that the universe was much hotter in the past than it is now. Otherwise, you're not going to get this progress towards decay. And those are the three fundamental principles of the Big Bang theory. And so the question is not whether or not it's a Big Bang, but really I think what divides us is how long has the universe been expanding? And I can suggest seven easy tests. There are a dozen more that are more complicated. But I think the two that are the most compelling is that stars and planets are impossible unless the universe has been expanding for billions of years. If it's only thousands, all you get is hydrogen gas. If it's trillions, all you get are black holes. Moreover, you can only get stable orbits of planets about stars and stars about the centers of galaxies if the universe has been expanding continually for billions of years.
Before Ken answers here, the fact is, where is the scientific community? Are they admitting that the universe had a start?
Yes.
Give me an example.
Well, you've got Stephen Hawking, for example, who produced the space-time theorem of general relativity. Theorem is based on only two conditions. If the universe contains mass, and a bathroom scale is usually enough to convince most skeptics, and number two, if the dynamics of the universe is governed by the equations of general relativity, then there must exist a cause that brings the universe into existence independent of matter, energy, and 10 space-time dimensions.
Okay, so it had a start. Are they a little troubled by that problem?
Very much. I mean, one of my books I wrote about how for 60 years, astronomers did everything they could to get around the implications of general relativity, but observational evidence forced them to accept that this is really true. In fact, general relativity now ranks as the best proven principle in all of physics.
All right. So to sum up, the fact is matter, energy, and all the rest has not been here eternally, which is what science is now saying and admitting. If you had a start, you had to have a starter. So in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth is coming on very strong in the scientific community.
Yeah, and it's not a Hindu starter, it's a Christian starter. I mean, what's unique about Christianity, it alone speaks about God creating independent of matter, energy, space, and time. Even time is created.
All right. Kent, you also believe the biblical statement that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, but you differ in believing when God did it. You think that he did it 6,000 years ago. What scientific evidence proves the universe is young and the Big Bang theory is not true in terms of time?
I would have to say if what you're proposing is true, then there is no possible way the average person in the world can read this book and understand it. The God that I worship wrote a book that anybody can read and understand, the vast majority of it. And this book clearly says God made everything in 6 days. They were days just like we have today. I think the Big Bang Theory is one of the most ridiculous ideas I've ever heard of in the world, and I think we'll have an interesting discussion on that tonight.
Okay, tell us why.
Well, Big Bang Theory does not explain the origin of time, space, or matter. What exploded? Where did it come from? Where did the energy come from? Why are some of the planets spinning backwards to others? You know, if a spinning object breaks apart in a frictionless environment, everything spins the same way, and yet we have Venus, Uranus, and possibly Pluto spinning backwards, and at least 6 moons spinning backwards. And he mentioned the everything is tending toward decay, and yet what he said about the Big Bang is exactly the opposite of that.
All right,
where did all this stuff come from?
Here, what do you come back with?
Well, I mean, we're talking about decay since the transcendent beginning. I mean,
well, why would God need to use a Big Bang? Why not just make it right?
Well, that's what he says he did. He says he created matter, energy, space, and time. That's exactly what the Big Bang is saying. It's identical. There's no difference between Genesis 1:1.
There's no difference between what you're saying and what Carl Sagan says. That's what I see. I see what you say as being totally foreign to God's word, and I get real nervous when somebody teaches something where we have to have a guru to explain it. Now you have a cult.
We don't need a guru.
Anybody can read this book and understand it.
As I said, you've got 6 different Bible authors speaking about the heavens being continually stretched out.
No, there are 6 different times where it says God stretched out the heavens. It doesn't prove the Big Bang.
Well, a Big Bang says that a transcendent being is the one that's responsible for that.
I agree there is stretching of the heavens, but
yes.
I don't think that proves it's billions of years old. See, that's where you went from the observation to the interpretation of the observation, and that's where you get into trouble.
Do you agree that the universe contains planets and stars?
We know that we have at least 9 planets around our sun, and yes, there are plenty of stars out there, trillions and trillions of them. I agree.
Well, there are planets and there are stars, and it's been expanding for billions of years.
Well, I guess we don't know that it's been expanding. We do see a red shift from some of the stars, and some interpret that to mean expanding. Some interpret that to mean tired light.
Let me slow this down for our people out in the audience there, and that is basically what you're saying is that, okay, if we do have planets and we do have stars out there, that, Hugh, I think what you're saying is that in astronomy, that there's a way of measuring how far away those guys are.
Okay? That's true.
All right, and I hear Kent saying, no, let's start. How do you know how far away they are? And then let's have Kent come back on that. In other words, what are the tip-offs?
Well, let me underline the principal point, though. The very existence of stars and planets means it's been expanding for billions of years. To support thousands of years, you've got to get rid of all the stars, planets, galaxies, and moons. And as an astronomer, I can tell you there really are stars out there. There really are planets and moons. It's not a mirage. We live on a planet. There's a star that supplies us with heat. That's all you need. It's very simple. You don't have to have a PhD to figure this out. I mean, the universe expands too fast. None of the protons and neutrons will ever coalesce.
How do we know how far away they are and how long it's been expanding?
Well, because of a new paper published just in the June 1st issue of Astrophysical Journal, I got the paper here with me, we now have trigonometric parallax distances as far out as 3C279.
What in the world does that mean?
That's a quasar that's 6 billion light years away.
But how do you know it's 6 billion?
Okay, how do you know? There are variations taking place inside the quasar that guarantee that the variations must be taking place over a certain number of miles diameter. Radio astronomers have developed a new technique where they can take telescopes all over the world and put together the equivalent of a telescope with a 6,000-mile diameter, which allows them to measure angles with extreme precision. And it's that technique that has enabled them to establish that this object is a minimum of 6 billion light years away, and therefore the light must have taken 6 billion years to reach us. This is independent of the expansion measures of the universe.
Ken?
Well, I was born at night, but it wasn't last night, okay? And I had students all the time that tried this same technique. It's called a snow job, I guess, to dazzle with big numbers. If you look at the, I taught trigonometry, I know how it works. If you took a look at Earth's orbit around the sun, which is a huge circle, okay? Earth's orbit around the sun is only 16 light minutes across. It would take light 16 minutes to go across our orbit, since we're 8 light minutes away from the sun. Some people confuse. They think a light year is a time. A light year is a distance. We could have a Hovind minute. You know, how far can Hovind run in 1 minute? That's getting shorter each year, by the way. But I could say it is 12 Hovind minutes to the store. Well, that's a distance. It's not a time. And a light year is not a it's a distance. It's just a shorter way to say a big number. Earth's orbit around the sun is 16 light minutes. 1 year has over 500,000 minutes in it, 525,948 minutes in a year. So if you're going to look at a star that is one light year away, and not forget your 6,000-year base of your triangle, I'm talking 16 light minutes, 186 million miles, I'll give you that. If you had two surveyors up on the roof of this building and they were 16 inches apart, and they were looking at a dot 8.25 miles away, that would make a very skinny triangle. Real skinny triangle. That's what you get. That's the same angle you get when you have two people looking at a star from opposite sides of Earth's orbit, and the star is only one light year away, and none of them are that close. So I just plain do not believe you. I've read your books. I learned an awful lot. You have some great stuff in here. But I think what we have here is a classic example of an exaggeration. They cannot tell a star
not
6 billion light years away.
You're wrong on this. Here are two papers that have been published. This one gives a trig parallax distance to NGC 4258.
And you can tell me.
23.5 million.
Well, can I talk trig? Explain this to me. You can say with trigonometry, you can measure 6 billion light years.
Yes, you can.
I just flat don't believe you. I'm sorry.
Okay. It's not just the diameter of the Earth's orbit that's going for you.
You can't tell where you were 6 months ago on opposite sides of Earth's orbit.
Hang on.
Okay.
The reason why we're able to do this now and not 5 years ago is we now have telescopes with extremely high resolution that can measure angles to better than a 10,000th of an arc second. This is what gets you out so far. We're no longer limited to 500 light years. We can measure all the globular clusters, and the Hipparca satellite did that, got us out to the globular clusters, but radio astronomy is getting us out to galaxies and quasars.
Okay, I would have to be convinced. Now, I am not saying the stars are not billions of light years away. They probably are. I just think it is hocus pocus to say we can measure those distances because we cannot measure those distances.
Yes, we can.
Secondly, we do not know. We do not know that the speed of light has always been a constant.
Got to bring that up. We'll talk about that.
And thirdly, the God that I worship is able to make a full-grown man in a full-grown garden and full-grown universe. He doesn't need 17 billion years to get it put together so we can live here. He can make it right in 6 days, and he's capable of writing a book that the average person can understand.
He's capable of doing all of that, but he's also capable of doing it in 2 nanoseconds. The question would be is, what did he do? Are the universe and the Earth billions of years old or just thousands of years old? What do you think? Are Genesis 1 and 2 compatible with contemporary scientific evidence? A lot of people think that's not true. Got two guests tonight who think that it is true. And my guests are Dr. Hugh Ross, who received his PhD in astronomy from the University of Toronto, did postdoctoral research on quasars at Caltech. Also Dr. Kent Hovind, who received his PhD in education, writing his doctoral dissertation on the subject of creation versus evolution. Now, I'd like to start off this segment right here with the fact of just going down something we can all follow, Genesis chapter 1. Haven't heard anybody do this. And we're going to see if the scientific evidence matches this. I think this will be helpful to those of you at home. I'm going to read it. My first question is, what happened on day one? Scientifically, the Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, let there be light. What in the world was that? And there was light. God saw the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, the darkness he called night, and there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Now, it seems to me you got a couple things here. God created the universe. God created the earth. It was formless and empty. God creates light. What kind of light? Is he talking about the sun or something else? God separates light from darkness. Does scientific evidence agree with this order? What else do you guys see that's going on? Kent, you want to start us off?
Well, sure. I think anybody of average intelligence can read that and say, well, on the first day, God created the material. He created the heaven and the earth, and then he made light. And he chose 6 days to do this and then a day of rest to establish a 7-day week for us. It's just 6 normal days, just like we have today. There's no difference at all. And Exodus 20:11, the only thing God ever wrote with his own finger, he wrote on a rock for Moses, the Ten Commandments. Everything else he had somebody write for him. He wrote on a rock with his own finger, and he doesn't stutter. He said, I made everything in 6 days.
Okay.
To me, that means he made everything in 6 days.
Hugh, what happened there? What's happening in day one?
Okay, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's matter, energy, space, and time, as you can easily establish by going to seven other Bible passages, which means there's light in the beginning. But it's dark on the surface of the waters of planet Earth because the light of the heavens could not get through the Earth's atmosphere to the surface of the Earth. As it says in the first creation day, let there be light. He uses the verb hayah, distinct from the verb bara in Genesis 1:1. God creates the light in the beginning. It shows up on the surface of the earth on creation day one. So creation day one is not the creation of light. It's the appearance of light on the surface of the waters of planet Earth. And now photosynthesis is possible on planet Earth. So Genesis 1:2, in my opinion, is simply the statement of four initial conditions. The earth began dark, water over the whole face of the earth, unfit for life and empty of life, and now the Spirit of God begins to work and transform.
All right, what about this word, and there was evening and there was morning, the first day?
Sure. You're reading out of the King James, the original?
No, reading this one off NIV, and,
okay.
But it is a distinct phrase that is used there, the first day.
It should say, and there is evening and there is morning, right?
Yes.
Okay, two verbs.
Right.
Two subject complements, and one of our Hebrew scholars, Paul Elbert, has written a piece on this very theme. And his point is that if it was going to be 24 hours, it would have to be an evening and an evening, or a morning and a morning. The fact that it's evening and morning establishes that the text is not speaking of 24-hour days, but one of the other two literal definitions of the word day, there being three. Could be 12 hours, 24 hours, or a long time period. All three are literal. Paul Elbert's point is the structure of the evening and the morning establishes that it's referring to something other than a 24-hour day.
Okay, let's just stay right here for a little bit, because both of you are Christians. Both of you believe that the Bible is the inerrant word of God, so it's not making a mistake here. Kent, do you agree we have three options?
List them for me, and I'll tell you if I agree.
Well, you've got how the word yam is used all through Scripture. You've got the day of the Lord, which has got to be more than a 24-hour period of time.
Okay.
Okay. You've got the fact of a 24-hour day, and then also it's used for just a 12-hour period of time, like the daytime.
I think if you gave this book to 5,000 people and said, read this, tell me what it says, all 5,000 would come back and say, this is saying he made it in 6 days. When you have to have a guru to tell you what it says, you now have a cult. That's what makes me very nervous. I think, let me read what James Barr says. He's a professor of Hebrew, or was, at Vanderbilt University, former Regius professor at Hebrew at Oxford University. He said, probably so far as I know, there is no professor of Hebrew of Old Testament at any world-class university who does not believe that the writers of Genesis 1 through 11 intended to convey to their readers the idea that the creation took place in a series of 6 days, which were the same as the days of 24 hours we now experience. Or to put it negatively, the apologetic arguments which suppose the days of creation to be long eras of time, the figures of years not to be chronological, and the flood to be merely local Mesopotamian flood, are not taken seriously by such professors. As far as I know.
That's simply not true. It wasn't true when James Barr stated it, and it's certainly not true today. Now, okay. I speak on seminary campuses all the time, and the majority uphold the idea that the text, the plain reading of the text, indeed implies long periods of time, not 24 hours. I mean, I'm testimony to that. I didn't meet Christians till I was 27. Mm-hmm. When I read the Bible for the first time, it was obvious to me it's speaking about six long time periods. There's no closure on the seventh day. You only got an evening and a morning for the first 6 days. You read Genesis chapter 2 and look at everything that happens on the sixth day. There are 10 creation accounts in the Bible. In order to develop a correct interpretation of creation, one must faithfully integrate all 10, not just focus on a couple of verses out of Genesis chapter 1.
Let me give you a hint here. Well, Dr. Gleason Archer was my Hebrew professor. And if we go to the next chapter, there's a tip-off, I think, in terms of what it is. Genesis 2:4, referring back to the 7 days, says, "This is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created," referring back to those 7 days. And then it says, "in the day that the Lord God made heaven and earth." So you have one day referring to all those seven. So you have it as a period of time. Now, Gleason Archer writes about this. "All biblical scholars admit that yom, day, may be used in a figurative or symbolic manner as well as in a literal sense. And he says this is very evident in Genesis 2:4. This is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created. Henry Morris, of all folks, says the King James Version translates the word yom as a period of time 65 times. So the door is open. And it's very interesting that even Moses himself is quoted in 2 Peter 3:10 this way. "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night." Actually, it's, "But do not let this one fact escape your notice, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is as 1,000 years. And he's quoting that from, I think it's Psalm chapter 90, verse 4, which is a psalm of Moses. And that's how Moses, who wrote this passage, used it. I'm simply saying that there's exegetical grounds for opening the door for a stage or a period of time among the scholars.
Yeah, Gleason Archer also made the point that on the sixth day you got Adam and Eve both created, Genesis chapter 1. When you go to Genesis 2, Adam hangs around a long time before Eve gets created. He's got to work the Garden of Eden, he's got to name all the animals, he goes through an operation, he recovers. And frankly, I think what's going on is God's dealing with them because men have a hard time integrating the physical creation, the emotional creation, the spiritual. He says, Eve doesn't need this college class, but Adam does. I think it took him at least a semester to get through it.
Well, the fact is for folks who don't know who Gleason Archer is, Gleason Archer has taught most of your Hebrew scholars. He graduated from Harvard with his PhD. I think he knows like 22 different languages. He used to take notes in Hittite when he was in class. I used to quote from the lexicon. He'd say, "That's wrong." He would correct the lexicon. I never knew anybody that corrected the dictionary. He'd write a letter, and they would correct it. He got my attention. And so if he's open to the idea, I'm open to the idea. But the fact is regardless, let's go on here in terms of the order. What happened on day two?
Well, I didn't get to respond to that
please,
one.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, I would disagree very strongly with what Dr. Ross has said.
Yes.
I think the days have to be six normal days because there are so many other references in Scripture. For instance, Exodus 20:11 in the Ten Commandments. God said, "I want you to worship on the rest on the Sabbath because I made everything in 6 days." He wasn't telling them to work 6 million years and then finally take a break. And the only two references you referred to about 2 Peter 3:8 and Psalm 90, verse 4, both of them say a day is like 1,000 years. They don't say a million or a billion. Plus, I think if you just read the first chapter, you'll see God made the plants, the grass, and the trees on day 3. He made the sun on day 4. And the Bible says clearly He created the sun. He didn't just make the light visible. I don't know where Dr. Ross gets this idea that the smoke cleared and all of a sudden they could see that the sun was already there. That's just simply not true. He created the sun. Just let me finish now.
You're wrong.
The Hebrew word is very clear there. And the 6 days of, I mean, how long can the plants live without the sun? Plus the insects are made on day 5 and they pollinate the plants. Plus animals breathe in oxygen and breathe off carbon dioxide. Plants do the opposite. The idea of these days being long periods of time is just ridiculous.
Well, let me just say this. So the sun wasn't created on day one?
The light was made. It doesn't say the sun was made.
Okay, I just want to make sure you're saying that.
Do you think
the sun
God
was created?
God is light.
There?
Definitely. And the fourth day does not say that the sun was created. It uses the verb again, hayah, let there be the great lights. In the 16th verse where it says, so God made the sun, moon, and stars, it's in the Cal Perfect form, which simply states that the sun and stars were made at some unspecified time in the past. Moreover,
even in
your interpretation can the plants survive 24 hours. They're not going to make it even a nanosecond without the heat and light of the sun. So
well,
obviously there's something wrong with your interpretation.
What I've seen from reading your work, and I probably got an awful lot of letters from people who said, boy, I wish I could be there to debate Hugh Ross. You know, I got a lot of people would like, there's many websites devoted to this topic, you know, of your appearance of knowing Hebrew when you don't know any Hebrew.
I've got either. A whole stable of Hebrew scholars that volunteers
so
for
read
us reasons to believe. Okay.
Sure. And I can talk to people who read Hebrew also, but I don't want you to, you know, mislead the audience into thinking you know Hebrew when you don't, and neither do I. All I can do, but I don't think God writes a book where we have to know Hebrew. The God that I worship is able to write a book and then preserve it and give it to us in a form that I can read and understand. And I'm telling you, nobody, if you went to a mission field where there were no Christians and no concept of Christianity and just gave this book to them and said, what does it say? All of them would come back and say, it says 6 days, just like we have today.
Kent, I've been on the mission field. That's not simply true. I mean, I've met all kinds of people who have drawn the conclusion these are long periods of time.
Please name one.
Okay. I mean, there's some ladies that work with us in our office, raised in Arkansas, read the Bible on their own, came to that conclusion. High school education, these are plain folk.
Well, there you had the key right there. If they got a high school education in the public school, they would have been taught evolution. And then they would have read the Bible with a preconceived idea.
I'm talking 11 years of age. I mean, this is before they hit the high school years.
Well, and when I read your testimony also in your book about how you came to the Bible, you had already decided the Big Bang Theory is true. That was already a given in your mind.
You'd already decided the Bible teaches it.
No, it doesn't. But you'd already decided the Earth is billion, the universe is billions of years old. And now you come to the Bible and try to force that interpretation on God's Word. That's the wrong way to come to it.
Well, let me bring up this thing about Exodus chapter 20 again.
Yes.
And that... Again, Archer comments on this. He did this at the Council for Biblical Inerrancy when they were writing the draft, and they asked him to do the exegesis on this. Gleason Archer used to teach at Trinity Divinity School. Bruce Walke used to teach, was chairman of Old Testament at Dallas. These guys wrote a workbook on the Old Testament together, and this is part of their commentary. In terms of Exodus 20, 8 through 11, in terms of what the Sabbath is mentioning and referring back to, he says, by no means does this demonstrate that 24-hour intervals were involved in the first 6 days any more than the 8-day celebration of the Feast of Tabernacles proves that the wilderness wanderings under Moses occupied only days. Remember, Israel wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. So it was a symbolic commemoration of that time is what they're saying. And I just point this out, that how do we, the very question you guys are grappling here for our people that are at home, how are they supposed to approach this? You've got the verse in Genesis chapter 2 where it does seem to say that a day refers to the whole spectrum of whatever time period those 6 days, 7 days occurred in the first chapter. You have the day of the Lord, which everybody seems to agree can go on into eternity. You've got other suggestions of periods of time. If it opens the door, there have been people that I have known that have just approached it and said that's a possibility. They haven't known the science, but it's a possibility. But I'm saying, if it is a possibility, are evangelicals wrong in exploring that possibility? Because you do have biblical support in other places for it.
I think you should explore all possibilities. I'm an educator. I think when you teach, a real true education shows the kids all the options. I think we should study that option that the days might be long periods of time. I would like you to show me any place in Scripture where it says a day is not a 24-hour day if it also uses the evening and the morning phrase with it, and the first day, the second day, the third day. I mean, the Bible just couldn't be more clear. And then it's reinforced in Exodus chapter 20 and in Exodus chapter 31 about God did it all in 6 days.
Well, let's pick that theme up. I mean, Exodus 20. That whole idea of the fourth commandment's repeated 5 times in the Levitical law. Only 2 of the 5 times does it give you the divine analogy, 4 and 6 days. And we also note in both cases the preposition's not in the original. It simply says 4 6 days.
Here you're
not
going
four
off in your imagined Hebrew again. Now let's stick
That's
with
not
something
imagined
like,
Hebrew.
You don't speak Hebrew, neither do I. Okay.
No, I've checked it out. I've checked it out with Hebrew scholars. They assure me that the preposition's not there. I've read the actual text. It's not in the original.
And have you read the long critique of what you just said on Answers in Genesis website about this very topic you're talking about?
Sure have.
And what's your response?
My response is it doesn't withstand the scrutiny of Hebrew scholarship. He also ignores the problem of Leviticus, chapter 25. There you got the case of God setting up a work period and a rest period for the agricultural land. It is to be worked 6 years and rested on the 7th year.
Correct.
So I go along with Gleason Archer. What you got in Exodus 20 is an analogy, not an exact equation.
Well, there I disagree.
All right, we're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going on to the second day to find out. We're going down toward Adam and Eve, when they were created, when the animals were created, and what was going on. So stick with us. We'll be right back. We're talking with Dr. Hugh Ross, who received his PhD in astronomy from the University of Toronto and did postdoctoral research on quasar at Caltech, and Dr. Kent Hovind, who received his PhD in education, writing his doctoral dissertation on the subject of creation versus evolution. Our topic is, are the universe and the Earth billions of years old or just thousands of years old? Are Genesis 1 and 2 compatible with contemporary scientific evidence? Should they be? And that's a good question, too, but we're going to go down using chapter 1 of Genesis, because a lot of folks have kind of discarded this. And I thought, let's have our scientists, let's actually comment on what these verses are talking about. We hit day 1 last time. We're going to talk about day 2, Genesis 1, 6 through 8, and says, "And God said, let there be an expanse between the waters to separate water from water. So God made the expanse and separated the water under the expanse from the water above it. And it was so. God called the expanse sky. And there was evening and there was morning the second day." Hugh, what happened on day 2?
Well, hopefully we agree here. I mean, I see that as a reference to God establishing a stable, abundant water cycle. In fact, one of our colleagues, Dr. Robert Newman, who's both an astronomer and a theologian, wrote his master's thesis in theology on that very point. Careful exegesis of the words reveals that it's speaking about God setting up an abundance of water in the atmosphere, the troposphere more correctly, water in the ocean, and you've got a cycling which is going to make possible sufficient water in the future continental land masses.
All right. Kurt? Okay.
Well, if God set up the water cycle then, why did it say later it had not rained upon the earth? What you're saying is, this: had it rained upon the earth for millions of years, was there a normal water cycle before? Is this all in day 2?
Definitely.
Well, if the Bible says very clearly it had not rained upon the earth.
No, you're quoting from Genesis chapter 2.
It says, "A mist went forth and watered the face of the ground because it had not rained upon the earth."
Yeah, but it's in the same context that there is no man, no plant. I mean, it's simply a restatement of the initial conditions you've got there in Genesis 1. I mean, what you have in Genesis 2 is a second account of creation with a focus on human beings.
The second account of creation focusing on day 6.
Yes.
All of chapter 2, except for the first 4 verses, is dealing with what happened in the garden only, and only on day 6. It's not talking about...
But you're quoting verses 5 and 6 out of Genesis 2, mm-hmm. and it's simply establishing the context for God creating Adam and placing him in the Garden of Eden and later creating Eve. It doesn't give you an ordered list.
How much later did he create Eve? Was it the same day?
The same 6th day, correct, which was a long period of time.
Which was a long period of time.
Right.
Okay, this is where you got to make sure I understand what you really mean by what you say, because I've read enough of your stuff to know to check that out. So you think Adam was there for a long time by himself. You say he had to recover from surgery and had to go to college for a semester and learn.
He had to name all the animals.
And that took a long time.
He had to work the Garden of Eden, correct.
Well, let's go back to day 3. We're going to get to that, all right? What happened with Adam and Eve, but let's keep it in context because our folks out here are trying to follow. So the fact is basically day 2, we had what happened?
Water cycle.
I disagree. Okay. I think on day 2, we had a firmament established, which is clearly later spelled out in Genesis 1:20 as being the place where the birds fly. Genesis 1:20 says the birds fly in the firmament of heaven. So that's the atmosphere. It says there was water above this atmosphere. That's what it says very clearly. And then also in Psalm 148, verse 4, it says there are still waters above the heavens. I suspect God made 3 heavens. First heaven is the atmosphere where the birds fly. The second heaven is where the stars are. We call it outer space, sun, moon, and stars. The third heaven is where God lives. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, the Apostle Paul tells about being caught up to the third heaven. And apparently there was a water barrier between each of those. The first one is probably now gone. That's what fell down at the flood. I don't know if it was ice or water or moisture or what.
But wouldn't it fall down immediately? What's going to hold it up there?
If I read your book, and you make a straw, what's called a straw man argument, you assume that all the water for the flood came from this canopy.
Even if some of it just came from the
canopy,
you've still got a problem.
No, there's water in the sky right now.
Yeah, but I mean...
There's plenty of it. Okay. Clouds are water, they float just fine. I don't know
what. So you don't believe there's any more water up there before the flood than after the flood?
I think there was somehow a canopy of water suspended up there. I can't prove this. This is the canopy
theory. Any different than what we have right now?
Oh, probably so. I think that
then it's got to come down.
It did come down. It rained 40 days and 40 nights.
No, it'll come down immediately. It wouldn't wait. I mean, the law of gravity is either going to dissipate it to outer space or bring it crashing to the earth.
There's plenty of water out there in the atmosphere right now.
But there's a limit to how much it can hold.
I agree. And it was right at that limit.
Which
most
isn't
of
very
them,
much.
I don't know that. And you don't either know what it was.
Yes, okay. I do.
No,
I'm
you
an
don't.
Atmospheric. I've taken
says,
atmospheric physics.
The Bible says very clearly that most of the water for the flood came from inside the earth when the crust of the earth broke open, the fountains of the deep broke open. That's where the vast majority came from.
Yeah.
And I think we still today have the scars where this happened. They're called fault lines. You know, San Andreas Fault, Hayward Fault, New Madrid Fault. And I've studied all those. None of them are my fault, but I've studied them. And I think that those, the flood in the days of Noah happened when this water came out from inside the earth and the canopy collapsed, which is one of the explanations.
Let me move you on, because you're going to get into it in the day three here as well.
Okay.
Let's just roll over into it. This is what happened on day three. God said, let the water under the sky be gathered to one place, and let dry ground appear. And it was so. God called the dry ground land, and the gathered waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds. And it was so. The land produced vegetation, plants bearing seed according to their kinds, and trees bearing fruit with seed in it according to their kinds. God saw that it was good. There was evening, there was morning, the third day. We have the receding of the waters of the ocean, seas and lakes taking place. We have the emergence of land above the seas taking place. Plants and trees come forth at that point. What else do you guys see taking place, and how long was this going on?
It took one day, 24 hours.
Well, I would see it as taking a much longer period of time.
How long?
Huh?
How long?
Oh, probably in the order of a few hundred million years. I mean, how you're going to get these continents forming, right?
The continents we have today?
Yeah.
No. The continents today are a result of Noah's flood. The shapes of today's...
That's 6,000 miles of plate tectonics in just a few months of time.
That is assuming, of course, that today's continents are like they were in the days of Adam and Eve. See, what you've done is you've taken some scriptures that clearly apply to the flood, the worldwide flood in the days of Noah.
Do you believe that tectonics is operable in the earth?
I was just on the San Andreas Fault last week. Yeah, it's moving.
Okay.
Sure. That's a result of the flood 4,400 years ago. The plates are still moving. The fountains of the deep broke open. The water came to the surface. They're still settling and shifting. I've climbed 40 volcanoes and taught earth science for years. Yes, sir.
But if you squish that much tectonics in that brief of a period of time...
How much tectonics? What are you trying to do? You're trying to put Africa and South America together? Is that what you're judging this by?
Either that or just produce the mountains that are necessary for your flood interpretation.
In order to make Africa and South America fit for the Pangaea theory they put in the textbooks, they shrank Africa 35 to 40%. Pangaea theory is just pure baloney. Plus, if you look...
Have you checked that out with geophysicists?
Well, just let me finish.
No, if you hold take it. The water, this is important.
Well,
if you're going to make these statements, the very least you've got to do...
Always check it out.
...is go to the geophysicists and say, give me your feedback. Have you talked to them?
I taught earth science for 15 years. Get any high school textbook, which is what I taught. Measure the size of the continents they show for Pangaea. Get a ratio, and then go measure it on a real globe. And you'll say, wow, how did they do that? Plus, all of Mexico, all of Central America is gone. They take them out. The shapes of the continents is a pure coincidence based on the water level. If you take the water out of the oceans, you will notice there is dirt underneath. These continents are not floating around like lily pads in a bathtub. They're connected. It's just the low places happen to be full of water. The opposite sides of most rivers are parallel with each other. That doesn't mean they broke apart millions of years ago. It's just a low place full of water.
Well, that's you stating it. I mean, again, check with the community of geophysicists and get their feedback.
About what?
About your plate tectonics theory. Is there any scientific support for your plate tectonics theory?
I agree. The continents are moving a little bit.
A little bit.
That doesn't prove... They're moving about as fast as your fingernails grow.
Mm-hmm.
As a professor of that subject that I know of would say, about as fast as your fingernails grow. Obviously, that doesn't prove they've always been moving at that rate. And just because South America and Africa are X number of miles apart, you're just judging by the water level. Take the water out and they're touching.
Come on. Paul says everything must be tested. If you're going to claim that plate tectonics was millions of times faster than the days of Noah...
I didn't claim that. Don't put those words
thousands?
In my mouth.
What
no, I didn't say that either.
Hundreds?
I didn't. All I said was... The shapes of the continents only appear to fit because of the water level. Yes, the continents are moving, but they've only been moving 4,400 years since the flood of the days of Noah.
How about during the flood?
I don't know. The Bible says the fountains of the deep were broken open. There was probably some incredible continental movement during that flood. And how you can teach it was a local flood, I don't understand that. I mean, why would God tell Noah to build a boat, fill it full of animals, stay in there for a year? Tell Noah to move. I mean, I can figure that out. It was a worldwide flood.
He could have told him to move, but the main purpose here is that God set up Noah to be a prophet. says, build this gigantic boat in the desert and preach to this wicked generation. If he had moved, he would have lost his opportunity to preach.
Do you really believe that?
Yes, it says so in Hebrews and Peter.
So the purpose of this ark was just to get attention. It was a
God always gives
hamburger Sunday to bring all the kids in.
A pulpit.
All right, we're gonna got to get to that too, but gee, we got to get through the 7 days here. Can I move on to day four? Because this gets us into the light again. God said, this is day four, let there be lights in the expanse of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them serve as signs to mark seasons and days and years, and let them be lights in the expanse of the sky to give light on the earth, and it was so. God made two great lights, the greater light to govern the day, the lesser light to govern the night. He also made the stars. God set them in the expanse of the sky to give light on the earth, to govern the day and the night, to separate light from darkness, and God saw that it was good. There was evening, there was morning, the fourth day. Question, did God make the sun? Did God make the stars on day four? Hugh?
I'd say no. It's in the cal-perfect form, which means that they were formed either on the fourth day, the third day, the second day, the first day, or in the beginning. Go back to Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the Shemayana rest. That includes all the matter, energy, space, and time, stars, and galaxies. So that's when the light was. That's when the stars existed. And what you see there in the text is these are to serve for signs for the animals that are going to be created in the fifth and sixth days. You'll note that all the animals mentioned the fifth and sixth days are sufficiently complex. They need at least the occasional visibility of the sun, moon, and stars to regulate their biological clocks.
Mm-hmm. This is one that I actually looked it up, and the Hebrew verb is wayas in verse 16, and according to Archer again, God had made the two great luminaries. This should be... Hebrew had no special form for the pluperfect tense, but uses the perfect tense, or the conversive imperfect, is here to express mm-hmm. either the English past or the English perfect. So what he's saying is God had made two great lights, da-da-da-da-da. So that seems to open the door that the sun and so on were already there. But it does say he also made the stars. Did he make stars on day four and didn't make them at the beginning?
Well, it's in the same cal-perfect form, which means it could have been made any time in the past.
Okay, third, so second, he also had made the stars.
Right.
Kent?
Well, I don't know Gleason Archer, and I know that an awful lot of the people in the past, Schofield and Dakes for the Dake Study Bible, were products of their time. They were trying very hard to make the Bible say the earth is millions of years old because of in the early 1800s, some people started teaching the earth is millions of years old. Christians panicked and thought, wow, they're going to prove the Bible's wrong. We've got to somehow make the Bible say this. And so in the early 1800s, you see the gap theory, the day-age theory, progressive creation, lots of these theories, which are just compromises. The earth is not millions of years old, for one thing. And why on earth should we compromise a perfectly good Bible, which has never been proven wrong, with a dumb theory of evolution, which has never been proven right?
It's not evolution.
Okay, your theory of Big Bang is exactly like Carl Sagan's.
No, it isn't.
Well, tell me the difference.
Okay, the difference is this. Carl Sagan doesn't perceive design in the Big Bang. We do. In fact, we stipulate that the greatest scientific evidence for design in creation is in the Big Bang characteristics.
And isn't that the opposite, though, of the second law of thermodynamics?
Well, of course. We have God creating the universe. He's setting up the physics of the universe.
Why not do it in 6 days like he said?
Now, he did do it in 6 days like he said. Six literal long periods of time.
Six literal long periods of time.
Yes.
So here you have day three, the plants living for millions of years without a visible, clearly visible sun.
I'm saying the sun was always there. What was going on is the atmosphere from day one to day four was translucent. Light was coming through, but the observer on the surface of the earth, the Spirit of God is brooding over the surface of the waters. From that perspective, he couldn't make out the distinction of the sun, moon, and stars, only the light. It's like where I was raised in British Columbia. We got to see the sun maybe 2 days out of the year because the rest of the time it's overcast. What you got going on before the fourth day is where it's overcast all the time. Fourth day, we have the atmosphere becoming transparent for the first time, and now we can have God creating creatures that need these things for signs to regulate their clocks.
Okay, I disagree. You're saying that the sun and moon were created. The word created and made are used interchangeably all through the scripture. I've got a list of about, I don't know, 50 or 60 places where they're used interchangeably. It means the same thing. He created and made.
Scholars don't agree with that.
Well,
there is a distinction between a saw and bara. Bara means you're talking about something that's really brand new. Mm-hmm. When the text uses the verb a saw, it doesn't necessarily have to be brand new, but it does have to be something that's designed or manufactured by the Creator. And I'm conceding that point. I believe that the Big Bang, the universe, the Earth, the solar system, our galaxy, were all very carefully fine-tuned and engineered by the Creator. Well, that's where I differ from Carl Sagan.
This brings up a great concern for me. After reading lots and lots of your material, I really feel like I'm talking to a Mormon priest, like you have a different God. It's not
Why?
The same God.
Why do you say that?
Well, the Mormons will tell you they love God. Okay, who do you mean?
Yeah, but the fact he's saying, Mormons are saying there's many gods. Okay, you can
maybe
become a god,
example.
I can become a god. Bible's not saying that. I don't hear you saying that. Are you saying that?
Well,
no.
The God that I worship not only made it in six literal 24-hour days, he's not deceitful. We don't have to wait for somebody to come along in the 20th century to explain it to
us. Let's talk about deceitfulness. Let's talk about that point. The fact is, that which is there, when the scientists find it, if it's not true, wouldn't that be deceitful?
Oh, yes.
Right.
And there's no conflict between the Bible and science. There's a conflict between the Bible and the Big Bang.
No,
and
but I'm saying is the fact is, take the very thought of the fact of the light coming from the stars.
Sure.
Okay? We've got to talk about this. We'll do it in another program because we've got to shut this one down. But the fact is that if the light is not what the scientists are saying that it did from all the measurements, then God had to create it in transit. Therefore, it's not really true.
No, that's a false assumption. You're setting up a straw man here. If the stars are billions of light years away, and they probably are, I wouldn't argue that, they probably go beyond what we've been able to see so far. You know, every time they look at a spot in space, they see more stars, you know. I don't know how far it goes. It probably goes forever. And that blows the human mind. You know, how can it go forever?
Well, it doesn't go forever.
You know that it doesn't go forever?
Definitely.
You've been there, done that.
Yes, we've done
extraterrestrial perception.
No, we can see far enough away in astronomy that we can look back to that epoch when stars
didn't
exist.
Are you telling me, and everybody and God's listening, that scientists have now observed the farthest star there is?
Yes.
Man, okay.
Why are you saying that? What's the evidence?
We have telescopes powerful enough to probe that far back in the history of the universe. In fact, one of the astronomers that volunteers for us, William Keel, at the University of Alabama, that's his research field, photographing the universe before galaxies exist, before stars exist, and showing the history of creation from that moment forward.
All right, we're going to wrap this up here, and the facts, we're going to come back. And there's a couple things when we come back, so please hang in there with us. Welcome. We're talking today with two guests, Dr. Hugh Ross, representing the Old Earth point of view, the day-age creationist viewpoint, and Dr. Kent Hovind, representing the young Earth creationist viewpoint. Our topic is, are the universe and the Earth billions of years old or just 6,000 years old? Also, are Genesis 1 and 2 compatible with contemporary scientific evidence? And this is a dynamite program right here because we're going to talk about what part did evolution play in the origin of life, if any? We're going to talk about how did God create Adam and Eve, and we're going to talk about light and a few other things, and we're doing it in the, just going down the list here of Genesis chapter 1, and I'm going to combine 2 days here, guys, because it's taking us a little longer than usual to get through these days. What happened on day 5 and day 6? Genesis 1:20 starts us with day 5. God said, "Let the water teem with living creatures. Let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the sky." So God created the great creatures of the sea and every living and moving thing with which the water teems, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. God saw that was good. God blessed them and said, "Be fruitful and increase in number and fill the water in the seas. Let the birds increase on the earth." There was evening, there was morning, the fifth day. Day 6. God said, "Let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, livestock, creatures that move along the ground, and wild animals, each according to its kind." It was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, over all the creatures that move along the ground." So it seems in these 2 days, you got to let the waters teem with living creatures, the birds fly across the earth, across the sky, above the earth, across the sky. He made the great creatures in the sea, then the livestock, creatures that move along the ground, wild animals, and finally, man. All right? First of all, start me off. Does evolution have any place in any of this?
I would say no.
Why?
Well, just by scientific modeling, we can determine that there is no possibility for a species changing into a distinctly different species unless it exceeds 1 quadrillion individuals with a body size less than 1 centimeter and a generation time less than 3 months, which means it's going to work for viruses and bacteria, but it's going to have no capacity to explain the existence of new species of birds, mammals, or any of the creatures we see from the Cambrian explosion onward.
Some folks on PBS are doing specials on chaos theory saying that that's the way it came about. What do you think?
Chaos theory, in my opinion, doesn't work. Yes, you can get departures from thermodynamic equilibrium if you've got a complicated enough system and pick a small enough volume element in that system, but there's an important corollary. The farther you depart a system from thermodynamic equilibrium, the faster it must snap back. As something as complex as a virus, the snapback time is less than 10 to the minus 120 seconds. So the fact that we're all older than that means that's not how we got here.
So you're saying all the plants, all the animals, and man, none of that evolved?
No evolution beyond, you know, not the species level, the genus level, order, family, none of that. Unless the species happens to have more than a quadrillion individuals, which is only a few.
Kent, you've offered $250,000 to anybody that could prove that theory. Give me some illustrations of why you think they never will.
Well, all we've ever observed is dogs produce dogs. Nobody's ever seen a dog come from a non-dog. Now, they might want to believe that a dog and a banana have a common ancestor. Well, I don't care what they believe, but that's not science. And I certainly resent my tax dollars going to support that. You need to get a King James, brother, by the way, because you said wild animals. The Bible doesn't say that. They weren't wild. They were all tame, all friendly animals in the original creation. They were all part of, you know, Adam got to pet them all when he went out for a walk. And the animals were all created on one literal day, the sixth day. And then Adam and Eve were both made on the sixth day. It wasn't a long period of time between Adam and Eve, like Dr. Ross believes. It was the same day. And there's... you know, the God that I worship is able to do it right, and he's able to do it in a few seconds.
Okay, you know? But you're saying that God could. Is there any benefit of God doing it quicker than 6 24-hour days? In other words, if that shows his power, why not do it in 2 nanoseconds and really show off? Why do you say that he couldn't have done it longer?
In other words,
when a painter paints his picture,
I understand.
Okay, he can take his time in doing whatever he wants. He's the creator.
Right.
Is there anything better about saying he did it, you know, over 10 billion years of age, 2 nanoseconds, or 6 24-hour days? Is there some spiritual quality that adheres to that?
Well, the only reason I can see for God taking 6 days, he could have done it in zero time. He doesn't need any time at all, you know, and could have made it perfect and right. And God doesn't need 17 billion years to get the stars just right to support life for this brief time period like Dr. Ross teaches in his books. My God did it right in 6 days, just like he said. We have a solar reason that we have a year. You know, we go around the sun once a year. We have a lunar reason that we have a month. You know, it used to be the month was about the same time as the lunar cycle. There's nobody knows why we have a 7-day week. There's no, you know, what's the historical reason? Why does every culture have a 7-day week? Napoleon tried to change it to a 10-day week, and it was a disaster. We're just kind of built with our biological clock to work 6 days and rest one. And it's normal days. God wasn't telling the Jews to work 6 million years and then rest, or work 6,000 years and then rest.
He told them to work the agricultural land 6 years, though.
Yeah, I think the 7-day week is established because of the creation. And the biological clock is just a normal, God just did it that way, just so we'd have. And I also think that God created. It says in Genesis 1 that God said, let us make man in our image. The very next verse says, so God created man. Here you've got an example where created and made means the same thing.
I don't think so. I think the making is referring to the fact that we have a physical component to us, which previously existed.
Previously existed. Do you believe Adam was literally made from dust and God breathed
definitely,
into his nostrils?
Definitely.
And Eve was literally made from a rib?
No, a side of Adam. Doesn't say rib in the text. It says a portion of Adam's side. So we don't really know what kind of biopsy God took out of Adam.
But you believe this literally took place?
Yes.
Well, we finally agree on something. There's one.
Okay.
So we believe that God made Adam. Now let's what are the tip-offs of when? We also have bipedal hominids going around, it seems, from anthropologists that go back past what the Bible says in terms of the genealogies that are given.
Sure.
Okay, let's talk about that. How far back do you think the genealogies take us in Genesis? Usher said it was 4,000 years.
B.C.
B.C.
Right. Well, the Hebrew scholars I talked to said there's obvious gaps in the genealogies. You can't fix a precise date like Archbishop Usher did, who assumed no gaps.
But there's also
a limit.
There's a limit.
Yeah, I would be hard-pressed to push it any earlier than, say, 50, 60,000 years. Mm-hmm. I got friends who try to push it back as far as 100,000. Anything beyond that, I think, is
right.
Illegitimate.
So the fact is that both you and Kent are in trouble as far as the anthropologists who want to take some of these other bipedal primates or hominids back to, what was it, a million years?
Yeah,
million
if you interpret the bipedals as human, then you've got a problem.
All right. So what do you guys do with them?
They're not human.
Why aren't they human?
They're just like the primates. They're like the chimpanzees, orangutans, gorillas.
You include Neanderthals as being in this category?
They're in that category, too.
See, I disagree.
Why?
The Neanderthals were deformed humans, probably post-flood. They were burying people after they died. If a person lives past 100 years, there's a disease called acromegaly where the pituitary gland keeps secreting growth hormones. Your ears get longer, your nose gets bigger, and your bones in your forehead get thicker. The Neanderthals were simply post-flood humans who were deformed from diseases, arthritis, rickets.
Kent, are you aware that they have enormous nasal capacities and that their DNA is radically different from human DNA?
Well, now, that's deceitful to say it's radically different. It's about 4% different, and it's within the range
that's
of humans
huge.
Today. You could go downtown Los Angeles and line up people and make an exact same chart like they've got in your textbook, with the skulls sloping, different diseases, and noses larger, nasal capacities larger.
No.
They're still human.
No. Okay, you can read a paper. I got the paper here. It's by Ian Tattersall and Jeffrey Schwartz. And they examined 13 Neanderthal skulls, complete skulls, and discovered that the nasal capacity was so enormous
it eliminated
the possibility that Neanderthal was biologically linked to any other land mammal species, not just primates. They said, we got a problem here. We got this Neanderthal that we can't link with anything.
You're saying just because their nose is bigger, they're not linked to anything?
It's not the nose, it's the entire nasal capacity.
Sure.
They have a nasal capacity that is so huge,
mm-hmm.
there's really no one. These guys are atheists. They're saying, now, how can we possibly evolve this gigantic nasal capacity from any other species we see in the fossil record or any other species we see on Earth? And they said, we can't come up with
it. I would agree.
That.
Nothing evolves beyond. I wouldn't use the word species. That's kind of a nebulous term, because a dog and a wolf and a coyote are different species. But they're still interfertile. They're the same kind. I'd stick with what the Bible says. The animals bring forth after their kind. A horse and a zebra.
How do you interpret kind? Do you think horses and zebras evolved?
I think horses and zebras are the same kind. I interpret kind like the Bible says. They're able to bring forth. The ones that were originally able to reproduce are the created kinds. Now, there's been variations from there.
So how far up do you put the kinds? I mean, I just don't know what your
I don't know that anybody knows that, and that would be a good field of research for science to get into.
Would you be willing to take it past genera?
I think with some areas. Now, see, what we have here is we're trying to take a modern 20th century classification system, you know, started with Carolus Linnaeus, has been refined many times, and we're trying to force that onto the Bible. Now, that's the mistake. Just the Bible says they bring forth after their kind. A horse and a zebra probably are the original created kind. One of the zoos in, I believe it was one in Hawaii, they had a walpin. They crossed a killer whale and a dolphin. Many zoos have had a tigon or a liger cross a tiger and a lion. They probably are the original created kind.
Yes, but they can't reproduce that kind.
Well, the walpin did. After 10 years, it produced a baby.
But not the liger.
I don't know about the liger. See,
yeah.
But even if they get where they
or
can't
a mule.
Reproduce...
You're arguing intramurally, and the big argument is from the outside. Does the fossil record support the evolutionists or not?
Plants, animals, man. Yeah, I never got a chance to respond to the caveman, I don't think. But
Well, I mean, let's stick with the outside world here for a moment.
Okay.
And the fact is, those folks out there are simply saying, both you guys are wrong. The fact is, evolution did take place. But I think most of our students recognize that even people like Gould at Harvard are making a shift here. Punctuated equilibrium is really going against what they originally started out with. All of a sudden, it just appears in the record. What comment on this, please?
Well, it's an excellent point, because what Gould and Niles Eldridge are trying to do is make evolution work where the mathematics tells us it is the lowest possible probability. I mean, when the species population drops down to a few thousand, you get a zero probability of evolutionary advance. When you look at the fossil record, where do you see the evidence for the so-called transitional forms? It's creatures like whales and horses. And these are creatures with population levels so small, generation times so long, body sizes so huge, they have a zero probability for evolutionary advance. They're even lower than our probability for evolutionary advance. Yet we see these all these transitions. My explanation for that, God loves horses and whales. He knows because of their huge size and small populations, they're going to go extinct rapidly. When they do, he makes new ones.
When you guys are on campus, what do you say to the kids that have grown up thinking that evolution is proven by the fossil record? What are the things that you use?
Give them a mathematical model. I mean, one of the things we're trying to do in university campuses is say, if you're going to work in this discipline, you have to integrate mathematics with biology. Here's the principle. Most mutations, or many more mutations, are negative than those that are beneficial. The best you get is a ratio of 10,000 to 1. In other words, mutations will tend to drive a species to extinction before it has an opportunity to naturally evolve, unless it has a truly enormous population size, more than a quadrillion, a body size less than 1 centimeter, and a generation time briefer than 3 months. Now you can go to the field biologists. Where do you see speciation going on in the real world? They only see it for those species that match the mathematical limits. Those that don't, all they see are extinctions.
Right. And you've got some great illustrations on DNA, too, Kent, in terms of people say, well, the DNA is similar between this and that, therefore they call that the transitional forms. But talk to that a little bit.
Well, he mentioned about God loves horses and whales, so when they go extinct, God creates new ones. This is the type of thing that makes me so nervous about people following his teachings, because there are so many things like this thrown in there that just are simply unsupported by Scripture.
Psalm 104.
The Bible says God finished his creation. He was finished. I don't think God's creating new species all the time. I think it was done. And when he looked at it, it was very good.
By the way, I agree. God has stopped creating new species when he created Eve. That's when he went into his period of rest.
And how long ago was that?
I would argue that it's probably the neighborhood of 30 to 40,000 years ago.
Okay, we could argue that for a long time, but I think it was 6,000 years ago, just like the Bible obviously teaches.
But you're both using genealogies to say there's an end in terms of the parameters. So you're both basically on the same point at that spot that God stopped. So you're saying that this origination of new whales, new horses, and so on was before that.
It was before that, correct.
Okay.
Just like Psalm 104 speaks.
But come back, please, because we only got about 2 minutes here, and that's this thing of the DNA. Because the kids hear this a whole lot in terms of there's similarity in DNA, so therefore a man is similar to this, that, and the other. And they use that as kind of a transitional deal.
The reason DNA is similar in so many different animals is we all have the same designer. Microsoft Word and Microsoft PowerPoint have millions of similarities. That doesn't prove they both evolved from Morse code. The same guys are writing the programs, that's all. And the same God designed the DNA of all the animals, and the DNA is incredibly flexible. There's a wide range of humans. There's a wide range of dogs. You get Great Danes and Chihuahuas, and they probably had a common ancestor. It was a dog. That doesn't prove a dog and a banana are related. So the DNA code is just so incredible. It must be an incredibly smart designer.
Take a moment. Can you remember some of the numbers on some things that just show the dissimilarity? There is no transitional forms going up.
Oh, yeah, I've got a chart on my website, drdino.com, people can look at, you know. Penicillin only has 2 chromosomes, so that must have evolved first, you know, and then fruit flies have 8, so they must be the next form, you know. Now, a housefly and a tomato both have 12 chromosomes, so obviously they're identical twins. I mean, it's hard to tell the difference between a housefly and a tomato, you know. A possum, a redwood tree, and a kidney bean all have 22 chromosomes. Identical triplets, you know, possum, redwood tree, kidney bean, average scientist can't tell them apart, you know. Monkeys, or chimpanzees, have more chromosomes than we do. Man has 46, tobacco has 48. So if we keep evolving, we're all going to be a tobacco plant. I mean, the whole idea is absurd, and how they believe this, I don't know. But they just don't like the idea that God created the world.
Okay.
It's obvious he did.
We're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to talk about what happened when Adam sinned. Was there death in the world before Adam sinned? And did the law of entropy only take place when Adam sinned, or was it in place before that? All right, because it has a bearing on whether God created in 24 hours or God created over long periods of time. So stick with us. We'll take a break. We'll be right back. And we're at a stage that's very interesting. Want to talk about entropy, the law of entropy, via the Bible. And before we do that, I'd like you guys for you to define what the positions are. You're both Christians, but you interpret the word day differently in Genesis. And Kent, first of all, start us off. What is it that you are saying? What's your position?
My position is the very obvious literal scriptural position that everybody would get if they just read the Bible. God created everything in 6 days, 24-hour days, just like we know today. Any interpretation other than that requires a leader to tell you what it means, and you end up with a cult. I believe that's what Dr. Ross has, is a teaching that requires him to tell us what the Bible says, and you establish a position of authority for yourself, and I get real nervous about that. The Bible says real clearly God made everything in 6 days. There was no death before sin. The flood in the days of Noah was a worldwide flood that completely destroyed the world about 4,400 years ago. And I see no scientific reason, and certainly no scriptural reason, to believe anything other than what the obvious plain teaching of Scripture is.
All right, Hugh, what's your position?
Well, I believe that the plain literal reading of the text is that it's six long periods of time. 10 creation accounts in the Bible, it's not enough to take the Bible literally, you must take it consistently. When you try to make all 10 creation accounts say the same thing, it's quite obvious it's impossible to interpret it as six 24-hour days. That must be six long periods of time. And as I mentioned previously, we're talking about a universe that's expanding. The Bible clearly teaches that. And stars and planets are only possible if the universe has been expanding for billions of years. If it's just thousands, all you get is hydrogen gas.
All right. Before we actually hit the topic, Christians in the church have different positions. You were telling me that the Presbyterian Church on their internet has put a statement after how long researching this topic?
Yeah, I got the statement here. It's 92 pages. It's the result of a group of theologians studying the text for a two-year period. And they all agree in biblical inerrancy that evolution can't take place. It's got to be supernatural creation. They take the Bible literally unless the context indicates otherwise. And they said there are four positions that fall within the pale of biblical orthodoxy. You got the day-age interpretation, which I represent. You got the calendar day view, which Kent represents. You have the analogical days. Then you have the framework hypothesis. And so they're recommending that all four views be encouraged and be taught within their churches.
Yeah. Would you guys agree that we need to have this debate in the church?
Oh, absolutely. Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. And the fact is that I know both of you have had folks make accusations against you. Hugh, you've even been called a non-Christian because you hold to the particular view that you do.
Well, I've been called a lot worse than that, wolf in sheep's clothing
and Kent, I've listened to some of your debates where you've actually debated university professors on campus, and it was a hot time. You did marvelously well. It's just among Christians, we want them to think about what the text is saying, and let me ask you both this question. What do we do with science and Scripture? In other words, how as Christians do we approach it? Some people say, the Bible says it, I believe it, I don't care what science says. There's other people who say, well, we've got the Bible, if it opens up the door, then science can lead us as to the interpretation. Others would say, forget what the Bible says, science first, then, you know, everything else will jam it
sure.
in there. What do you guys think?
I think you have to make a distinction between the record of nature and science, and the words of the Bible and theology. Theology and science can definitely clash and contradict because human interpretation is involved. But God created the universe. He's the one who inspired the words of the Bible. It's a God that can't lie. The record of nature can never contradict the words of the Bible. But where we do see contradiction between science and theology, we need to look for human misinterpretation. In fact, I welcome these disagreements because it's a wonderful way to ferret out the interpretations that may exist on either or both sides.
What do you think?
I agree. We need to look for human misinterpretation. But what Hugh does, he looks for human misinterpretation of the Bible. as opposed to looking for human misinterpretation of the scientific evidence?
I look for both.
Well, what I've seen in your books that I've read is you're quick to jump on some idea that maybe the Bible didn't really mean what it clearly teaches, and you've already decided, I think you've been crippled by your education because you think the universe is billions of years old. I mean, that's a given in your mind. That's an inflexible. And that's not logical to come at the Bible study that way.
But wait. The fact is that don't we all start with some presuppositions?
Oh, sure. Everybody does, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
if the Bible clearly taught that it was young, I would believe that in spite of my astronomy. What I see is the Bible teaching it just as emphatically as a scientific record.
Okay, that is not what... Let's go to... You pick a spot where nobody's heard of the Bible. Let's pick out 5,000 people. Say, read this, please. 0 out of 5,000 are going to come back like he believes.
No, Kent.
Maybe that's right. One little grandma in Arkansas. Okay. I forgot. 1 out of 5,000.
No. Look at the early church fathers.
Sure.
Okay.
The Hebrew calendar says this is the year 5795 or something like that. The Hebrews believe the creation was about 6,000 years ago.
So my point is, when you read the writings of the early church fathers, they wrote 2,000 pages on the 6 days of creation, more than any other text in the Bible.
You're talking about Origen?
I'm talking about
Augustine.
Yeah,
you better read some of the other things those guys believe, too.
Yeah,
I'm going to stick with what the Bible says. I don't care what any early church father
says. But when you say stick with what the Bible says,
sure.
Take the area of eschatology.
Sure.
Take the area of church government. Take the area of baptism. Take the area of predestination. Okay? There's a lot of disagreement in the church on that. That doesn't mean that they're not Christians. And the fact is, the Bible itself has to be the standard. The question is, the guys at the biblical inerrancy thing went around the circle on this thing for days and days and days. All right? And people like Francis Schaeffer, Gleason Archer, Walter Kaiser, Norman Geisler, they all looked at this, and the fact is they took this day-age position.
Right.
They recognized other people took your position, but they kept the door open because of the fact is that they saw that there was credible biblical evidence that opens that door so that the scientific evidence has a chance of getting in there.
All right. You're doing the same thing Hugh's doing, though. You're confusing science with the idea that the Earth is billions of years old. It is true we see stars. That doesn't prove they're billions of years old.
Yes, it does.
See, there's where the problem is. What we have...
Talk to any astronomer
on
that issue.
We can go look at Grand Canyon. We can make three columns here. A fact. Grand Canyon exists. There are two interpretations of this. It took billions of years to form, or it formed very quickly in the flood of the days of Noah. What he's confusing, and I think you just did too, John, you confused the interpretation with the fact. You got to be real careful there.
Yeah. There's another way of approaching it, and that is, let's say I'm all wrong in my view.
Okay.
And you start off with coming to the Bible. First thing I would do is when I'm looking at eschatology or whether I'm looking at predestination or whether I'm looking at Jesus saying, you have to be a little child to come into the kingdom of God.
Sure.
The fact is, these have meanings, and the text itself has to interpret that for you.
Sure.
When you say, have other Christians come to this position, yeah, guys like Francis Schaeffer, who led the way in terms of apologetics and trying to reach non-Christians, he held this view. Guys like Gleason Archer that do know all these languages, they were thrilled to see this. They've written the lexicons and so on. They're saying these words allow them that door. They're not saying that, therefore, because the door is open, that this is what science is saying. Look, anybody that had a view 500 years ago and said our Bible view and our science view match up, the fact is it'd be wrong today because science looks like it changes every hour around here. All right?
And they used to teach the universe was a different number. And now he was saying 17 billion.
I'm not saying 17.
Well, that's the number I see in your book here.
14.9 billion.
Oh, 14.9.
Plus or minus a half billion.
Now, 20 years from now, when they pick a new number, he's going to be left out in the cold because he's put so much emphasis on this Big Bang theory and so much emphasis on this billions of year stuff that when this changes, he's going to look silly. 1905, the official age of the Earth, I've got the textbooks, was 2 billion years. Today it's 4.6.
That's still a lot older than what you're prepared to concede.
From 2 billion to 4.6 billion is a gigantic jump.
Hold it.
The fact is they don't know.
I've read the paper. The guy who wrote the 2 billion was Edwin Hubble. If you read his paper, 1929, he cautioned people outside of the field to look at this as anything more than a demonstration the universe has expanded over billions of years, because it said his data points are really noisy. This needs to be done with greater precision.
Okay.
We've done that with greater precision. Now we got the number down to better than 10%. Wait a couple years, we'll get it down to 5%.
You're convinced the Earth is 4.6 billion years old, and that's within 10%.
It's better than that. It's within a tenth of a percent.
Ooh, 4.57
billion, 4. Plus or minus 0.01.
See, this is what magicians do, is they dazzle the audience with these numbers, you know. Wow, watch this over here while there's a magic trick going on.
The difference is that if the scientific community is using every which way to try to establish that,
but see,
why would we be against the fact of at least looking at their evidence?
Oh, I think we should. But see, the confusion comes when you tie the interpretation to the fact.
Yeah, but
yes, Grand Canyon is there. One group says it took billions of years. I say, wait a minute now. The top of Grand Canyon is higher than the place where the river enters the canyon. Rivers don't flow uphill. That river didn't make that canyon.
Yeah, let's talk about the flood and that a little bit later.
Sure.
But the fact is, in terms of... I think you were saying, let's go back to that speed of light thing, because we missed that in the other program.
Yeah, we do see the stars.
The fact is I think you've said now that there are quite a few ways that you've measured speed of light.
Right.
I think 13 different tests that scientists have made in terms of speed of light, because it's been challenged within the scientific community itself. And, of course, if the speed of light gets messed up, then Einstein's relativity theory goes down the tubes, string theory goes down the tubes, all kinds of things go down the tube. But give us a little background of why now you feel so sure about the speed of light.
Okay. When astronomers measure hyperfine split lines, we're measuring the velocity of light when the light left that star or galaxy. And astronomers have been routinely making these measurements on millions of different objects. What we see is the identical velocity of light that we measure here on Earth. We've been able to do this to galaxies as far away as 14 billion light years. So the velocity of light has not changed over the past 14 billion years. That's a direct measurement. Now, we can combine that with a theoretical measurement, E equals mc squared. If you make c different, it's going to affect E or m. The velocity of light is a little bit higher for Adam than it is for us. He gets incinerated by the heat of the sun, or he don't have the elements to make Adam in the first place. Digestion. Human digestion depends on the velocity of light. We note that Adam and Eve were eating in the Garden of Eden. Therefore, the velocity of light had to be the same for them as it is for us.
And you also were talking, and then I'll let Kent get in here. The fact is, apparently, there's certain lines that spread out as it gets to us.
You're talking about the idea that maybe Duane Gish makes the proposition, for example, that light didn't come from the stars and galaxies. God sent it from an intervening point only 6,000 light years out. But we can prove that's not true through direct observation. As a beam of light travels through space, it passes through dust and gas. What the dust will do is redden the continuum. It's kind of like we see the moon during a forest fire. It gets redder and redder as the smoke gets denser and denser. And as it goes through gas clouds, those gas clouds have movements, and that's going to Doppler broaden the spectral lines. And therefore, a test of whether or not the objects came from the stars and galaxies, are there more distant objects, more reddened in the continuum, and broader in their spectral lines, and it's a direct proportion. The farther away the object is, the broader the spectral lines, and the deeper the red of the continuum.
Which all means what?
It means the light must have come from the stars and galaxies rather than from some intervening point.
And in measuring that light, you get a time of?
If it came from those distant galaxies, then the light must have been traveling for billions of years, because the velocity of light we can measure and prove theoretically did not change.
Okay, we've got about a minute 30 left. I'll give you the last minute 30. Go for it.
I recommend that anybody watching this call Duane Gish and say, did you really say that? Because I bet I got 25 or 30 letters and calls from people saying, Hugh Ross misquoted me. He didn't, you know, it's not correct.
He said it in my presence.
There's a long
times.
Website on Answers in Genesis, you know, a long expose of Hugh Ross.
What about this light coming?
Last June of the year 2000 at Princeton University, they speeded light up to 300 times the speed of light. In February of this year at Harvard University, Dr. Howe from Denmark slowed light down to 1 mile per hour. I said, I think there
nothing
are three
physical
things. To, it's my turn
can
now.
Hold it.
There are three things to consider with starlight. We do not know that the speed of light has always remained constant all through history. The way we measure light now is with an atomic clock using the wavelength of a cesium-133 atom. So if light is slowing down, your clock is slowing down at the same rate. You have a rubber ruler. You're never going to notice it since 1962.
We don't use that method.
Let me finish. Then, secondly, I mentioned earlier, you can't tell the distance to these stars 14 billion light years away. They might be. They probably are. But we can't measure that. And it's silly for us, for humans, little humans on Earth, to say, we know the distance to that star 14 billion light years away. It can't be done.
It's high school
Thirdly,
trick.
The God that I worship made a full-grown man, a full-grown garden. He didn't make two babies and put them in the garden and say, here's a package of seeds, go plant them quick, you know. There was the fruit already on the trees. That's not deceptive. It's necessary. It doesn't work otherwise. And the reason God made the stars was for signs and for seasons so Adam could see them. God made the stars and the light all simultaneously, or the light traveled faster. My God is not limited by stuff like that. And I get real concerned that maybe we're talking about different gods here when
well,
we talk about
let's
you know,
expand this segment here, because we don't want to end it right here. The fact is that, respond to that.
Okay. Astronomers view the credibility of a young Earth as being much weaker than that for a flat Earth.
Wait. Just this blanket statement. Astronomers
okay.
say, as if he's speaking for all astronomers. I just spent the last 3 hours with Danny Faulkner, who's an astronomer, who would love to debate you, by the way.
Sure.
And would you be willing to do that?
Definitely.
Oh, please call Danny Faulkner from South Carolina.
Keep going.
He says you're wrong. The Earth is only 6,000 years old.
Yeah, based on the Bible. He's admitted to me that if you look at the astronomical evidence, there's no case. He's been arguing in print for years that young Earth creationists need to pay attention to astronomy because they got a profound challenge there. Now, my point was this. Given that the astronomical community, and I'll accept Danny Faulkner.
I won't give that. See, right away, you're assuming everybody's on your side, and
no,
it's just simply not true.
Hang on. Given that there are so many well-known astronomers who have put in print the statement that I've just stated, shouldn't you at least talk to those astronomers and determine why they view the astronomical evidence for a young Earth to be
sure,
so incredible?
Sure, I'm willing to read anything, write anything on the topic. I'm willing to talk to anybody, but I think you've got some built-in assumptions.
Well, how about the velocity of light? I mean, clearly, there's no case for the velocity of light varying.
No, don't
Yet
say
you
clear.
Continue
there is,
to preach
there is
it.
A great case for the speed of light. I taught physics. We used to measure the speed of light in the hallway with rotating mirrors and a laser beam.
Do you believe that astronomers can measure the velocity of light when they look at distant stars?
If the base for measuring the speed of light is the atomic clock, I think you
it's
need
not.
To understand you have a rubber ruler.
It's
Are
not.
There 13 different ways to measure the speed of light?
There are many different ways to measure the speed
okay,
of light.
Okay, so the fact
atomic
is...
Atomic clocks is only one.
Do they all agree?
They all agree. Same answer to 10 places of the decimal. At all different distances, all different
if
times.
If that's true, what does it mean?
That's being measured here on Earth.
No.
We don't know that the speed of light, you've never been to the moon, you've never measured the speed of light out there. We don't know that the speed of light may be consistent. I don't know. My point is, we don't know what light is. Is it a wave, a particle, a photon? What is light? Give me a jar of it and paint it red. Nobody knows what it is.
What do you think?
What is light?
We know what light is.
What is it?
It's a photon, which has both a wave property and a particle property. I mean, it's the principle of quantum mechanics.
Well, you're giving it a name, but that's not telling me what it is.
A light packet is a set
it's
of photons.
It's a packet?
Yes.
Ziploc bag or what?
Okay, we're talking about quantum. Do you believe that quantum mechanics is true?
Well,
I mean, not all young Earth creationists do. I don't know what your position is.
I guess I'd have to get the question phrased more clearly. Well, exactly what do you mean? Einstein's theory was that the speed of light is a constant. Time is the variable. Maybe he was wrong. Maybe time is the constant and light is the variable.
Okay, the velocity of light, as Einstein stated, it was for a vacuum. I mean, examples you gave were not vacuums,
mm-hmm.
where the velocity of light traveled different rates. It travels 186,000 miles per second
but
in a vacuum, and it's a physical entity. Now, a wave peak can obviously travel faster than the velocity of light. In fact, you could have the physical object carrying the light moving at just 2 miles an hour, and yet the peak of the wave could go 10 times the velocity of light.
Mm-hmm.
So you're misrepresenting Einstein or relativity when you say that just because a light pulse goes faster than the velocity of light, that disproves the whole idea of variable speed of light or
you realize
constant speed of
how
light.
How much doctrine you are hanging on this one idea? You've already come to the conclusion the universe is billions of years old. And now you're going to try to force this book to say that.
No, I get it independently from the text.
You wouldn't have got that had you gone to school in some other country, or the Hindus, or some other. You would have come
Early
to a different
church
conclusion.
Fathers figured it out long before the astronomers got into the game.
Yeah, let's then shut it down here because the fact is I think we got our point across of where you're coming from
okay.
in terms of light, and what we're going to do in our next program is we will continue it. I still want to get to this thing of when did entropy begin. Did it begin at the beginning of the universe, the Big Bang, or did it start only when Adam sinned? So please stick with us. All right, let's take a break. Let's go. Welcome. We're talking with our guest, Dr. Hugh Ross, representing the Old Earth Day Age Creationist Viewpoint, and Dr. Kent Hovind representing the Young Earth Creationist Viewpoint. Our topic is, are the universe and the Earth billions of years old or just 6,000 years old? Also, are Genesis 1 and 2 compatible with contemporary scientific evidence? And right now we're talking at an interesting spot, and that is, in terms of the Bible as well as science, when did entropy, the second law of thermodynamics, come into place? Did it come into place when God created everything at the Big Bang, or when God created it on, Kent, you'll have to tell me, first day, or when Adam sinned? Now you say, what in the world does that have to do with it? Well, the question comes up of Romans chapter 5, verse 12, what the Apostle Paul talks about when he says, therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way, death came to all men because all sinned. Did death come into the world only at the moment that Adam sinned? Well, if it did, then the fact is that the days have to be 24-hour periods of time. Why? Because you've got the animals and the plants. Or are you saying that death does not apply to the animals and the plants? The animals and plants dying, we're talking about entropy. Do the stars burn down before Adam sinned? Is digestion taking place? Am I going the right direction here? Start me off, would you?
Okay, you're referring to Romans chapter 8, which says the entire creation is subjected to the law of decay. That means all of the universe throughout all of its space-time dimensions. And so I would interpret that the second law of thermodynamics has been in effect since the creation. As you pointed out, you got stars before the fall of man and after the fall of man. Stars are extremely sensitive to the laws of physics, including the laws of thermodynamics. Stars are impossible without the second law of thermodynamics, gravity, and electromagnetism. You got Adam and Eve eating before the fall and after the fall. Again, extremely sensitive to the laws of physics, including thermodynamics. What happened at the fall, as we see in Genesis 3, is that humanity changed, not the world. The curse was that there would be more pain, not pain for the first time. There would be more work, not work for the first time. Adam, after all, was commanded to work the Garden of Eden before he sinned. Therefore, we got the continuous operation of the laws of physics. And as an astronomer, I can tell you, if there was any change in the laws of physics, we would see a discontinuity as we look back in time. We see no such discontinuity.
Define death, then.
Okay, Romans 5:12 is speaking about human death. That's when human death came into effect for the first time. Notice the text says, death through sin. Only human beings amongst all species of life can experience death through sin. And then Paul closes it off by saying death through sin was visited upon all human beings. He's careful to exclude the plants and the animals, as he does in 1 Corinthians 15:20-22. Again, he limits it to humanity. And so, yes, there was no human death until the fall of Adam and Eve, but that does not exclude plant and animal death. And hey, if Adam and Eve are eating, obviously plants are dying.
Okay. Kent, start me off in terms of when did entropy start? What happened when Adam and Eve sinned? What kind of death are we talking about?
The earth was created, and heavens and earth, everything was created in six literal 24-hour days. Apparently, entropy came in when Adam and Eve disobeyed God. It came in as a result of the fall. Before that, had they not sinned, they would have lived forever. And of all the things that Hugh Ross teaches that I would object to, this one is probably the most serious. This one, I would say, borders on heresy because it leads right into why did Christ die on the cross? If there's already death in the world, see, his philosophy is God created a world where the lions eat the zebras, suffering and agony and is normal. And then when you read Genesis 1:31 at the end of the chapter, God looked at everything and said it was very good. If that's his idea of very good, then we have a very different God, which leads to the question, why did Christ die on the cross? The Bible says one man, Adam, brought death into the world, and that verse you just read is Romans chapter 5 and verse 12, but it also says in Romans 5:14, then nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses. And he says it didn't affect the plant and animal life, and yet the Bible clearly says because of Adam's sin, thorns and thistles are going to grow. It certainly affected the plant life. Animals died, a sheep died, lambs died because of man's sin. All through the scripture you see the animals suffering because of man's sin. This is heresy, and it bothers me because the more I've prayed about this and thought about this, it makes me wonder if we have the same God. We're using the same term, but I see the same thing in other cults. You know, they use the same terminology, but they mean something different.
Yeah, and but let's slow that down. The fact is, why does it mean you have another God to interpret the fact of sin?
Well, his God is a God who created suffering and misfits and death and ruin.
All right, let's back that up. So what you're saying is that on day 4, 5, before Adam, okay, even if they're 24-hour periods of time, was the sun burning down? Were plants being eaten by animals? Were whales eating fish?
As far as eating plants, I don't know that I would argue that plants are alive in the same sense that animals and people are.
A plant
is a complex, self-replicating food source. And you don't have to kill a plant when you eat it. You get into the question of, you know, he's going to strain at the gnats here and swallow the camel of, you know, saying, well, maybe the cells died or something like that. You guess you first have to define life, what the scripture defines as life, and then decide, was there death? The Bible clearly says no death came until Adam sinned.
Okay. But the scripture attributes life and death to plants and lower animals, not just to human beings.
To animals, I'm sure it does, but it says the grass withers, the flower fades.
Now, I can show you 4 places in the Bible where it actually uses the word death, the Hebrew word for death, mut, for the plants, or flies, for frogs.
Now you're into animals, not plants.
Plants, okay. I've got a list here. You want to see my scripture list? I have it here.
He's missing the bigger point, though. In 1 Corinthians 15, it says, the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death.
Human death.
See, you're adding to the word of God here, and the Bible puts a curse on people to do that. Read Revelation.
Paul says to all men, and he says death through sin. He is the one who limits it to human death.
Okay, why did lambs die? Why did the Israelites sacrifice a lamb or an oxen? Is that an example of an animal dying from man's sin?
You're assuming that all shed blood...
You're not answering my question.
No, hold it. You're accusing me of heresy.
I believe you are, yes, sir.
Okay, and you're saying I'm distorting the atonement doctrine of Christ.
I believe that, yes.
What you're saying is that all shed blood of sheep is for atonement. I don't agree with that.
No, I didn't say that. You're putting words in my mouth. When
therefore,
animals
there's no problem with death of plants and animals before the fall, if indeed not all shed blood is for atonement. So it's not heresy.
Well, lots of blood is shed that's not for atonement. Blood is shed in time of war.
That's my whole point. Well, why are you charging me with heresy?
You're arguing apples and oranges here. If you have death before sin, you're saying this is the way God made it. And when God looked at everything in Genesis 1:31 and looked at everything and said it's very good, I don't think it's very good for the zebra to have the lion tear his guts out.
Okay, maybe we disagree on eschatology. I believe the perfect creation, the new creation of Revelation 21, will replace the very good creation of Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. There's a much superior creation that's coming. Yes, it was good. It was very good, but it was not perfect.
It was very good when the animals were being eaten by each other. You're saying that was very good.
Hang on. Just answer the question.
Yes or no?
I'm disagreeing with you. I would argue that conditions would be worse for the herbivores if you take the carnivores away. There'd be greater suffering if there wasn't carnivorous activity.
So that's a roundabout way of answering the question. Yes, you believe God originally designed it for the herbivores to be eaten by the carnivores.
Correct.
Okay, I disagree so strongly. And I think that you really get into some wild doctrines then.
Well, let me bring up the fact here. The fact is, the Bible says, in the day that you eat, you will die. Did he die on that day?
He died spiritually. There are 3 kinds of death in the Bible.
But so he didn't die physically on that day.
Well, if a day is like 1,000 years, nobody made it over 1,000. So I guess yes, he did in that sense. He died physically. He began to die right away. That's probably when the second law was introduced.
So the fact is that it's not necessarily talking about physical death there.
Well, let me ask you one question on the same topic.
Yeah.
If Adam had not taken the fruit, would he have eventually died anyway?
I think so. Let me try. I've been thinking about both of what you would say, and I don't know what you're going to say on this, I've been thinking about that because it talks about the fact of you've got this tree of life, okay? And you see, you can't eat the tree of good and evil, but the fact is you can eat of this tree of life. It was expected that he would. Now, after Adam sinned, okay, God put the cherubim at the gate so that he couldn't go back in. Apparently, he could have eaten even after he had sinned, implying the fact is if he did, he would have lived forever as a sinner. So actually it was God's grace that he kicked him out, so he would die physically, could be redeemed, and so on. Right. But that would imply that he had to eat in the garden of that tree to stay alive, which would imply to me that he could have died. Doesn't it?
Well, you got along several assumptions from the fact. I mean, you get several generations
okay,
away from the
minute,
fact.
Okay, 1 minute, so wrap it up. Okay. Give me 30 seconds and 30 seconds.
Okay, God created a perfect world. There was no suffering. There was no death. It was man that messed it up. Death is an enemy. The Bible says death is the last enemy that shall be destroyed. The Bible says death reigned from Adam to Moses. Jesus said in Matthew 19:4, the creation of male and female was the beginning. To say that there was death before Adam's sin is heresy, in my opinion, and I don't know of a kind way to say that, which makes me worry for, are we talking about the same God? Are we talking about the same salvation? I don't know those questions. That's between him and God.
Yep. Okay. The fall did not take place in the Garden of Eden. It took place before the Garden of Eden. Satan was the one that fell first, not Adam. God knew ahead of time this was going to happen. I believe in foreknowledge and predestination. God, recognizing that sin was going to come into the world through Satan, and he gave Satan permission to invade the Garden of Eden. That was God's purpose, to let Satan in. He didn't have to. And therefore, God set up the laws of physics in advance to efficiently deal with sin so we can be ushered into a new creation where there will be different laws of physics. And as Paul says, it's going to be far greater than any of us can think or imagine. It's not just a restored creation, it's brand new.
Thanks, guys. And we're going to come back with a final word in just a moment. Talking with our guests, Dr. Kent Hovind and Dr. Hugh Ross, about science and creation, evolution. We're talking about, is the age of the Earth billions of years old or just 6,000 years old? And we're talking about, how does all this square with the Genesis record? It's been a very interesting talk, and we're going to do questions and answers now from the audience, and I can hardly wait to hear what these folks are going to ask. Number one.
This question is for Dr. Hovind. We know that you believe there are several areas where the science needs to be reinterpreted to agree with the words of the Bible, but do you believe there's any instance where the traditional interpretation of the Bible needs to be adjusted to agree with the scientific evidence?
I guess I'd have to know what you mean by whose traditional interpretation of the
theology.
Bible?
Theology. Do you believe there's any instance where theology needs to be adjusted to agree with science?
Well, I don't know of any contradictions between the Bible and science. I love the Bible. I love science. I taught it for years. So between a lot of different theology is kind of a broad term. I mean, you're talking about Catholic theology, Mormon theology, you know, Presbyterian theology. The more you read the Bible, the quicker you become a Baptist, basically, is what happens.
Well, to give an example, okay. How about the fact that 1,000 years ago, some Christians thought the Bible taught that the world was flat?
I think you'd find if you studied that out, it was some heathen that were teaching the earth is flat, and a lot of Christians today get accused of believing things in the past. The Bible clearly teaches the earth is round in Isaiah chapter 40.
I would agree with that.
So there have always been oddballs that believe things that are, you know, not contrary to Scripture. That's why we're having this debate tonight.
Sure.
I'm going to try to get you converted.
Question.
I have a two-part question for Dr. Hovind.
Sure.
The first of which is, when do you believe we have a consistency, with the exception of the miracles, in the traditional laws of physics?
I believe God created everything in 6 days, just like he said he did, and things have been consistent, except for a man's fall introducing entropy. Had it not been for Adam and Eve's disobedience, I believe there would have been no death in the world. Everything would have persisted forever.
So when exactly is your definition of consistency in the laws of physics in terms of time?
Well, right from the beginning. I think if God created things and then he took his hands off and allowed them to run down, that's not changing the laws of physics. It's the same God. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's not changed.
So you're in agreement then that the laws of physics have been consistent throughout God's existence?
Including thermodynamics.
Well, throughout God's existence. Now, God is eternal. See, I would not try to put God into our laws. God is not subject to time, space, and matter. He's above and beyond and outside of all of those.
But I am looking for a specific definition from you as to when the laws of physics have been consistent, because you have debated throughout as to how long the laws of light, in terms of their properties of speed, have been consistent. So the Bible has commanded us to test everything. And in order to do that, we need a stable framework.
Right.
So we need an indication from you, I guess, considering that you're the one proposing this theory, as to when we can actually consider the environment of physics to be stable.
As far as from man's observation point, it's been from the creation. Now see, Jesus can walk on the water if he wants. He can walk through the doors. I mean, these are contrary to the laws of physics. But so you're trying to mix apples and oranges, I think, here. God is not subject to the laws of physics. He created them. He's not subject to time. This is not the year 2000 in heaven. There is no time.
When did entropy enter the universe?
Well, I already answered that. I think entropy came in at the fall. That's so far the best answer I would have on that.
So you don't have a time frame?
Since the fall.
The fall was probably 100 years after the creation.
So 5,900 years?
I wouldn't be real dogmatic on the date, but yeah, I'd say.
Approximately?
Sure.
Okay. So that being the case, if we look at, let's say, the most modern finds within Japan that indicate a civilization dating back 10,000 years through clay figurines and things of that nature, it is proven that the decay of carbon exceeds your 6,000-year period by 4,000 years. Why would God do that?
I think you need to come to my seminar, because on video number 7 of my seminar series, we cover that. Carbon dating is a far cry from an exact science. They dug up a mammoth. The front leg dated 21,000 years old. The skin dated 44,000 years old. Same animal. I give lots of examples on my website, drdino.com, where I explain how carbon dating works, the problems associated with it, the automatic assumptions that are built in. And I sure wouldn't say they found a clay figurine in Japan that's 10,000 years old, therefore the Bible is wrong. I would question the carbon dating.
So you think that carbon dating is not valid?
I didn't say that. I said carbon dating, you get all kinds of wild numbers, and you can carbon date the same object and get different numbers. When they brought back the moon rocks, they gave them to NASA, dated them, got lots of different numbers from the same rock. So you need to, I can't take an hour to answer that question now, but I can answer the question. Carbon dating gives wild answers. Living snails will carbon date at 27,000 years old. And I document all of this on my website. You can see all the problems.
I've got a question going back to this deal on entropy, and that is that if entropy did not happen until Adam sinned on the sixth day, was there no burning down of the sun on the fourth day, third day, etc.?
If the sun is burning, there's two theories about how the sun burns, you know, by gravitational collapse, therefore it's burning up its fuel, and therefore, or the other one is just nuclear fusion. It's just, you know, take very little energy, would go a long time. I don't know how God would have done that forever.
Both involve entropy.
Yeah, the sun is burning, that's no question. How God would have done that, you know, forever. The fact that we see so many things in entropy, like the moon leaving us a couple inches a year, or the human population getting more genetic load, all of the things from entropy indicate the universe is not billions of years old. Maybe, you know.
Let's talk about that one, too. The fact of the moon pulling away, you got the moon in a couple of examples. Number one, of the moon pulling away a couple inches every year. Therefore, if you take it all the way back to the beginning, the Earth ought to be young. All right? Is there something wrong with that idea?
Definitely. He's assuming that the spiraling away of the moon from the Earth is linear. No astronomer believes it's linear. Newton's laws of motion prove that it can't possibly be linear. If you use those laws, you discover that it's consistent with the moon separating from Sun's zone close to the Earth about 4.25 billion years ago. And so the spiraling away of the moon is consistent with an old Earth interpretation, not a young Earth interpretation. I think it's good to point out, too, if you're saying no entropy until the fall of man, that also means no gravity, no electromagnetism, no nuclear physics would be taking place. Those are all intertwined with entropy. So you get a complete breakdown of the laws of physics in the young Earth view at the fall of Adam, which I have argued contradicts what the scripture clearly teaches. It's also something that can't possibly be hidden from the astronomer's view through the telescope.
As far as when entropy came into the world, I don't know. I suspect it was at the fall of Adam. The Bible says God looked at everything at the end of chapter 1 and said it was very good. The Bible tells us very clearly in Exodus 20:11, God said, I want you to rest on the seventh because I made everything in 6 days, everything in heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is. And if the average layman cannot understand that verse, then the Bible is incapable of being understood.
Well, I agree with that. It was done in 6 days.
You see, this is...
I mean, you see that in the Westminster Confession, that God created the universe in 6 days. Notice the Westminster Confession doesn't say six 24-hour days. It just says 6 days.
I could add that for them if you'd like.
I would prefer you don't, because okay. I don't think they would have. I mean, there's a reason why they didn't stick that in.
Because they've never been to my seminar.
All right, let's go to another question here before we get a question from the audience. And that is, let's pick up this thing of moon dust, because it's come up in quite a few conversations we've had in the past. And that is that at one time, folks that were scientists thought that the amount of moon dust that was being collected on the moon would be over 146 feet. In fact, the space pod was getting ready for that. And that was calculated by the number of years that it was supposed to be up there in terms of being very, very old. When they got there, it was, what, two inches or something?
Half inch, maybe.
All right. So what has taken place? What does the lack of moon dust, one way or the other, prove?
Well, the moon dust experiment was first attempted in 1960. Hans Pedersen, I've got the paper, you can check it out. He took a filter 4 feet off the ground on Mauna Kea, assumed all the dust coming through the filter was cosmic dust. But he states in his paper, quite obviously that's not true. There's going to be a lot of Earth dust circulating through this, so this is simply a limit. He encouraged in his paper that the experiment be done with balloon experiments, better yet, satellite experiments. Those were done a few years later, where they discovered he was off by at least a factor of 1,100 times. The measurements they got from the satellites predicted that 4.25 billion years of accumulation of dust on the moon should give you about 60 millimeters. When they went to the moon, that's what they found. So it's consistent with an old Earth interpretation, not a young Earth interpretation.
What do you think?
I think you get an example where your prejudice, your preconceived idea, determines your observations. The dust from the moon is only one part out of 67 is really from outer space. Most of it is regurgitated lunar soil. When an object hits the moon at high speed, it blows up a bunch of other dust. So I think if you figure in the 1 to 67 factor, there's a whole lot of these equations on Walt Brown's website, creationscience.com. He says 1.2 billion years ago, or no, that was about the distance to the moon. He says there should be about 1,000 feet of dust on the moon in 4.6 billion years, figuring in the 1 to 67 factor. I don't know how much dust should be on the moon. I know there wasn't much. And I think that's consistent with a young Earth model, that the whole universe was created in 6 days, just like God said. I have no problem with that.
You can't get 60 millimeters of moon dust in such a brief period of time.
Well, see, you the problem you have, Hugh, is you're stuck with this uniformitarian assumption. The Bible predicted people in the latter days would come that would teach the way things are happening now is the way they've always been happening, 2 Peter chapter 3. And you're an example of this. We see the moon dust in 1960 and 1970 and 1980. We check the dust today and assume, well, that's the way it's always been. This is uniformitarianism. This was Charles Lyell's problem. And several times in the last previous debates, Hugh has referred to, you know, the fossil record or the geologic column. Well, I taught Earth science for years. You can only find that dumb geologic column one place in the world. That's in the textbooks. It doesn't exist. Charles Lyell made up the whole thing. All those layers, well, some other people helped, but all those layers of rock that we see were formed during the flood in the days of Noah. I've got pictures on my website of petrified trees standing up, running through a whole bunch of different layers.
You're misrepresenting the field. What geophysicists and geologists believe is that it's a combination of catastrophism and uniformitarianism.
Here you are speaking for all geologists again. You do this consistently, and I wish you'd stop and think about what you're doing.
Well, find a secular geologist that doesn't endorse catastrophism. They all endorse it.
I can find lots of geologists that don't endorse the idea that do believe all those layers were deposited in a flood.
I would agree, but many floods, not just one.
No, just one big flood formed nearly all the layers. And so, in one sense, it doesn't matter what any geologist says. What does God's Word say? It's real clear. Your idea of a local flood in the days of Noah, then you're assuming that all of these layers of rock that we see all over the world were formed slowly over billions of years.
Some, there's, not all.
Okay, nearly all. There's just no difference between what you teach and what the evolutionists teach. And your teaching is going to destroy people's faith in God's Word, and it's going to not lead people to the Lord. It's going to young Earth creationism is the plain obvious interpretation.
Let's hit that. I mean, we just got to stop there. The fact is, why? In other words, when you have people like Francis Schaeffer, Norm Geisler, Gleason Archer, Bruce Waalke, and a whole lot of folks like that that may disagree on a 24-hour period of time, you can't accuse them of being non-evangelistic, not standing for the inspiration and inerrancy of the Word of God.
Right,
you can say they disagree, but you can't accuse them in terms of motive. And I think also the fact is that right along this line, there's one verse that is an interesting one. I've been thinking about it. Excuse me for butting in on your time here. Psalm 19, 1 and 2 says, and you've both quoted this in your stuff, "The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they display knowledge. There is no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world." Now, my question is this, is the message that's being conveyed just that God is the creator and these guys are spectacular? Or does the message that they are proclaiming in terms of distance and years, is that also a true message? We come back to this thing, the speed of light, how you measure the distance to the stars and so on. What do you think?
Well, twice the psalmist says the heavens declare the righteousness of God. So I would argue that the psalmists are trying to make the point that the heavens declare not just that a God exists, but the God of the Bible exists. You know, and I've written in my books, if you look at the record of nature and the universe, you see that it must be a transcendent being, transcends 10 space-time dimensions, matter and energy. We can identify that this God is trillions of trillions of trillions of times, etc., more powerful than we human beings in his capacity to design and create. Likewise, more intelligent, more knowledgeable. And I think the real distinctive is that we can demonstrate from that record that God is caring and loving. Now, of all the gods of the religions of the world, which one transcends 10 space-time dimensions? Which one reveals himself as trillions of trillions of trillions of trillions of times more creative, more powerful, more knowledgeable, more intelligent, more caring and loving than we human beings? You're really left with just the God of the Bible. Now, my problem with the young earth interpretation is all that evidence is erased. The heavens do not declare the glory of God.
What about this appearance of age, Kent?
Well, Adam, how old was Adam when God made him?
Brand new.
Did he look brand new?
He looked brand new.
He looked like a sperm or an egg or a fertilized embryo, or was
he
a full-grown
man? Well,
let
me put it this way. You and I have liver spots on our skin. In fact, the teenagers in this audience have liver spots on their skin.
Right.
They're not brand new when you examine them up close using medical methods. But I believe that when God created Adam, yes, he was tall, fully capable, fully functional, but he was brand new. No liver spots, no chipped teeth, no gray hair, no baldness. He was brand new. Because when God creates, that's how he creates. He doesn't create with the appearance of age. He never creates with the appearance of age.
That is the appearance of age. Look at him. I mean, he's old enough to walk, talk, get married first day.
You're assuming he comes from a womb. The text tells us he doesn't come from the womb of a woman.
I know.
He's specially created by God from the dust of the earth.
And Eve was made from Adam's rib, not his side, like you said. It was just a rib, is what the Bible says. But they were full-grown, fully mature human beings in a full-grown garden. They didn't have to wait 3 or 4 years for the trees to produce fruit.
I don't agree they were mature. I believe that both of them are brand new when God created them.
Could they speak?
God gave them that capacity.
So they came pre-programmed from the hand of God, fully formed, fully functional.
They were fully functional. It's the chicken or the egg. God makes the chicken first.
He makes the chicken. I agree. Now, why can't he do that with the stars? What is your problem there?
Well, because the text doesn't use the word bara with respect to the stars. It does for Adam and Eve, but it doesn't use that word for the stars.
Well, I showed you where it does. In chapter 1, it says, God, let us make man in our image. The next verse says, God created man. It uses them interchangeably, and there's hundreds of examples.
I'm not agreeing that it's interchangeable. I believe it's referring to two different characteristics of humanity.
See, that's only to make it fit your theory, though.
Hold it. The spirit within us is brand new, never existed before in the animal kingdom on earth. It happened for the first time with Adam. Now, there's parts of us that are not brand new. We have physical bodies, just like the other animals have physical bodies. Therefore, the text doesn't use bara to refer to our physical capacity. It uses the word asa. It still attributes to God the miraculous. God himself performed a miracle of taking the dust of the earth, which wasn't brand new. It's been around for a while.
2 days, right.
Okay, whatever you say.
Yeah.
A few days. I agree it's been 6 days. It's been sitting around. but six long days. But with respect to the spirit, that's brand new. That never existed in God's earthly creation until the sixth day. Just like with the animals, when it says on the fifth day, God created the soulish creatures. Notice there again, it uses both verbs, asa, bara. There's something about those creatures that is brand new that never existed before.
So, but before that, they were animals without a soul, without a consciousness of life? Or?
Well, I mean, you're getting into a debate here. What does Genesis mean by the soulishness of these bird mammal creatures? And sometimes we see in the New Testament, for example, it's connoted with the spirit, but there it's referring to human beings. Mm-hmm. You look at the context, I believe what it's speaking about is how birds and mammals are uniquely endowed by God with mind, will, and emotions so that they can form relationships with us human beings. I don't know about your kids, but my kids have had these pet insects when they were young. But they gave up on them because there's no relationship there.
They're dumb.
Whereas with the birds and mammals, they can maintain a relationship.
Right.
So there is something distinctive about those creatures.
I agree with that. I think we're way off topic for the question that was asked, though. We'll go back to the original one there, John.
All right, let's try it here.
My question's about the canopy theory. Mm-hmm. You've been critical, Dr. Hovind, of Dr. Ross because he makes a lot of use of 20th century science. But I never hear young Earth creationists talk much about the origin of the canopy theory. And as best I can determine, it was developed by a man named Isaac Newton Vale. He was a Quaker. He was a self-taught geologist. I'm not sure he was a Christian. He was an evolutionist. He believed the Earth was millions of years old. And this 19th century discredited theory has been embraced by young Earth creationists. Aren't you doing the very same thing that you have criticized Dr. Ross for doing?
Well, first of all, you accused me of being against 20th century science. That is simply not true. I love science. I've seen no scientific evidence to go against this book. I see a lot of 20th century interpretations of scientific facts that are contrary. But you're confusing the interpretation that somebody gives to the fact. Here's Grand Canyon. How did it get there? Some guy says billions of years. Okay, now you can't make his interpretation part of the fact that it's there. All we know is it's there. So I'm not against science. I love science, okay? I've not seen any scientific evidence to contradict the young Earth creationist model, an instantaneous creation, 6 days. I've never seen any scientific evidence. I see evolutionary interpretations that contradict that. And there's no question the Bible has a lot of conflict with evolution. And I think the Bible has a lot of conflict with Hugh Ross's teachings. But there's no conflict between science and the Bible.
Now, how do you explain the existence of stars in a young Earth interpretation?
Well, I did. Now, let me finish this question here. Critical of science. As far as the canopy theory, I don't know who invented it. I never heard of this guy you mentioned.
I have the book, and I'll be happy to give it to you.
Well, that's fine.
This is a reprint of his book.
The fact is, I read the Bible, and I look at science, and I see several interesting things. Insects are found in the fossil record that are huge. Insects breathe through their skin. There's a real problem as an insect gets larger. It breathes through spiracles in its skin. As you increase the size of an insect, the surface area to volume ratio changes radically. And you have a problem where it can't get enough oxygen. And we find dragonfly. They found one in Italy here recently with a 50-inch wingspan. Well, a 50-inch dragonfly couldn't possibly fly today. Something was different. 2-foot grasshopper fossils are found. 18-inch cockroach fossils. In Germany this summer, they found an 8.5-foot centipede fossil. Something was different on this planet because insects today cannot get that size because of the surface area to volume ratio problem. They just don't have enough skin to absorb the oxygen they need. Plus the flight. You know, pterodactyls are found with 50-foot wingspan. They couldn't fly today.
All right, sum it up.
Something was different in the Earth, in the atmosphere. Amber is found that has 30% oxygen in it, in the air bubbles. Today we have 21%. Something was different. The Bible says there was water above the firmament. That's all I can say. I clearly state in my seminar, it's called the canopy theory. It's gone, whatever it was. It fell down at the time of the flood. I couldn't prove it. It's just a theory.
You want to comment?
Well, I have in my office a book written by a young Earth creationist. It's a thesis looking at 100 different canopy models. And he admits as a young Earth creationist that every one of them is scientifically flawed. And says the young Earth community right now doesn't have a viable canopy theory. And for the very reasons I mention in my book, you can't keep the thing stable.
Refresh our memory, then. What are you saying that the text says?
Well, I believe that the text is saying that there was a fully functional water cycle from the second creation day onward. I mean, as I look at Genesis 2, I see two Hebrew words, ed matar, rain and mist. But as you look at the lexical definitions, it's simply a matter of degree. One's referring to bigger liquid drops of water, one's referring to smaller liquid drops of water. And as a geologist friend of mine pointed out, we have fossil evidence of falling raindrops in shale and sandstone rocks that go back before 10 million years. Rain was here, and would also fit the whole idea of the covenant theology. When God uses something to sign one of his covenants, he always picks something familiar within the environment to sign that with, like water baptism, or food and wine, and therefore there must have been rain and rainbows before the flood for God to use that as a covenant signature.
That question.
Okay. This is directed to Dr. Ross, but first for Dr. Hovind. I have studied Hebrew, and Dr. Ross does an admirable job. He's done his homework. We've talked personally about some of these things, and yet this is directed because we do have some differences. And so Dr. Ross, with in relation to the word yom used in the Old Testament, 359 times it is linked with a number, a numerical index. All but a few times, like Hosea 6:2, it refers to a literal 24-hour solar day.
Sure.
So the evidence seems to support a 24-hour day. How would you deal with this?
Well, how I would deal with it is to make the point that those 300-plus references you found are in the context of human history, whereas what you've got in Hosea chapter 6 is a prophetic reference using the word day. What you have in Genesis 1 is a reference towards the natural creation. It's a different context. The other references are referring to human history. So you have to examine the context to see which way you should take one of the three definitions.
And doing that, there is very good evidence that it is a 24-hour period. Now, you know, as we've talked, that I'm really open to looking at all the options. I want to know the truth. A lot of people listening want to know what is really the case. And you have presented some very good evidence. And we need to spend time sifting through, pulling these things together. And I think, I know for me, Yom is still a problem. And I think for a lot of other people. So what would you say that we need to do in seeking truth or a good evidence in this area?
Well, you know, I like problems. I like disagreements because it's a wonderful way to learn. Mm-hmm. I mean, every time God takes a doubt away from me, he gives me three new ones I didn't know I had in the first place. I think that's how God teaches us. What I would recommend, we have to stop using the charge of heresy or heretic because all that does is raise fear and it shuts down communication. We need to open the communication up. If people will dialogue without these charges of heresy or you're not a Christian or you're leading people astray, I think we can get this settled. All it takes is to get people to talk in a peaceable environment where we accept one another's Christian testimony.
One comment I would make, in Hosea chapter 6, when it talks about the day of the Lord, that may be a literal 24-hour day. There is going to be a day when he comes and redeems this world. So to take the 300 references where it's clearly a 24-hour day and say we have one where it's questionable, that one still could be a 24-hour day. And then to build a whole doctrine based on that one questionable verse, I think that's real thin ice to be skating on.
But if you only got one passage in the Bible where numbered days refer to natural creation, that establishes an entirely different context.
Well, again,
that does give you the basis for an exception.
I would go back to what I've said many times. What your interpretation of Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 2 and Exodus 20:11 and the Ten Commandments, that interpretation requires a guru to come up with that.
I disagree.
The average person doesn't read it and say that.
How about Genesis 2, in the day that the Lord created? In other words, that day doesn't refer to just one day.
I think it does. I think in Genesis chapter 2, it says, in the day the Lord created the heaven and the earth. That's referring to the first day, and then it goes right on.
Well,
so to assume you're talking about that day, meaning 6 days, I think you're reading into the text right there.
Most scholars would strongly disagree with you on that. I mean, even young earth creationists like Henry Morse, for example, accept the fact that Genesis 2:4 is referring to something other than a 24-hour day.
Well,
the context is quite clear. Take a look at it.
Yeah, I've read it many times. The 24-hour day, 6 normal days, evening and the morning, it's got the number, the first day, the second day, the third day. And I'm sure you can find somebody who speaks Hebrew who will say that's not talking about a 24-hour period. But that's only because of what they've been taught here in the 20th century.
No, that's because of their research. That would be like saying that these fellows that we've mentioned that are leading our evangelical seminaries, that somehow they've been swayed by the outside world. And I'm saying those are some of the strongest Christians I know that called me into obedience to the text. So the fact is, I think we can disagree, but to say that that they're not looking at all the records, I just don't think you can do that.
No, I don't think you're a heretic because you don't think the days are 6 days. I think if you have death before sin, now you've crossed over the line where that's a heretical doctrine. And the Bible says there's going to be heresies, and somebody's obviously wrong. We can't both be right. I think we should discuss this, and I'm thrilled to be here. I could go all night with this. But I think I'm going to stick with what the Scripture plainly teaches. It's just
so
obvious.
So you're claiming Gleason Archer is a heretic?
Oh, I don't know. Never met him. I don't care what anybody believes. I care what does the Scripture say. I can read it, and I can understand it. I think the average person can, too.
But can't you understand how that just closes down discussion when you say, hey, if you believe in long creation days, you're a heretic and should be ejected from the church?
I didn't say that. I said if you believe there's death before sin. Now, that doctrine I would put in the category of heresy. Believing the days are long
period of time. But you can't disconnect that from long creation days.
Well, you got a good point there, so you better consider what you believe. Titus chapter 3 says I'm supposed to warn you twice and then reject you. Well. So there's my first warning.
All right, question.
I have a two-pronged question. The first is, in as much as creation was an unprecedented activity and nobody was there, is it not reasonable to assume that what we see today in an imperfect world may have been radically different than what was created in a perfect world by God when he looked back at it and said it was very good? Would not maybe the law of physics and thermodynamics have been quite different?
Okay, the mistake you're making is you're assuming nobody was there to see it. Astronomy is a discipline where we cannot measure the present. As an astronomer, I can't tell you anything about the present universe, but we directly observe the past. If we look far enough away, we can be direct witnesses to creation. So yes, through astronomy, we can go back in time and actually check the miracles that God had performed. This is why the strongest evidences for the God of the Bible and science are coming from astronomy. Because astronomy is where you get the clear, direct witness to creation. The other sciences, you have to infer it, but in astronomy, you directly observe it.
But you're looking back, possibly through glasses that are out of focus, are you not?
No, not at all. I mean, if there's a discontinuity in the physics, there's no way the astronomer would not see it. All you would do is go to a certain star and say, wow, the physics is different there. We don't see that. The physics is consistent. Moreover, it's part of the anthropic principle. If you change in the slightest any of the constants or laws of physics at any time in the history of the universe, from the creation event onward, you destroy the capacity of the universe to support physical life. One reason I can tell you the laws of physics haven't changed is you and I are talking to one another right now. We wouldn't be able to do that if the laws of physics had ever changed after the creation event.
But aren't you speaking from a base of knowledge that is very far from being complete? Don't we use about 0.1% of our brains?
Well, I would argue it's complete enough. I mean, the very fact that we've got telescopes powerful enough to look back to the moment when light first separated from darkness means that we really do have a clear witness.
Okay, I would say, again, I don't think we can measure those distances to the stars. And if we do, it still doesn't prove anything. A light year is a distance, not a time. It's the distance that light, that star
but
is away.
What do you do with the geometric distances? The fact that we have geometric distances out to 6 billion light years.
That's where I am convinced you're mistaken.
I've got the paper right here.
I got lots of papers too, but let me just show you. The Bible says very clearly in Exodus chapter 8, we behold the work of God, and you cannot find out what God has done by beholding nature. Hugh's idea that nature is the 67th book of the Bible really put up red flags with me as I read his work. I said, oh, wait a minute now. The Bible says you cannot behold the work. They cannot be reckoned up. It says in Psalm chapter 40. You can behold God's works, but you cannot comprehend them. And he's putting an awful lot of eggs in one leaky basket, saying that because the stars are... His whole argument is the Big Bang must be true because the stars are 17 or 14.9275, whatever it is, billion light years away. This is simply silly. You can't measure those distances. You
By
don't know
way,
light's been the same. And if God can make a full-grown man and a full-grown woman and a full-grown tree, he can make stars in light. And six times it says he stretched out the heavens. What if he made it here and flung them out and it was 6,000 years ago, and it now appears to be that far away because he flung them out there.
The text says he continually stretches them out.
I think they're still moving. They may still be moving.
Right. It's still expanding. Always has been expanding.
Could be true.
From the creation event.
Which was 6,000 years ago.
And by the way, my only argument is not just that stars exist. That's one of 20 independent measures we've got for measuring how long the universe has been expanding. If you like, I can take you down the other 19.
Well, I can give you lots of quotes from astronomers who said the redshift in the early days, they thought redshift indicated distance to stars, and it may not.
Well, we can now confirm that through the equivalent of trigonometric parallax.
If you think you can measure trigonometric parallax to 6 billion light years, I'm going to have to call you.
The paper's right here.
Here's
take a look at
of paper
it.
Here. A bunch of paper. That's not an argument.
No, I mean,
this is your appeal to authority.
This is
which is so classic of what you do. And I think if people would read this book, you would see I've got so many notes in here that I'd love to go over with you sometime. And I think you're a real nice man, but I think you're just mistaken scripturally and scientifically on some of these things. This universe cannot be billions of years old. We've seen things winding down.
Let's back that up. The fact is, if he's wrong scientifically, then the paper would be wrong.
I don't know what's in that paper he's got, but to hold up a paper and say, here's proof, that doesn't figure any weight with me at all.
Okay? No, this isn't difficult to understand. Any layman can understand these papers I've got here.
I think this paper is real easy to understand, and any layman can understand this also. God made it all in 6 days. And any other interpretation than that is a cult. We have to have Hugh Ross to tell us what this book says. I'm sorry. There were people around before you.
The fact that you use this word cult and heretic and heresy.
I know, and it bothers me to have to do that. But the Bible warned us those people would come in the last days. It really does, you know, because you're such a nice guy. I'm sure some of the Pharisees were nice guys, too, and gave their kids camel rides when they got off work. But that doesn't mean they're right. And so you have to separate, you know, demeanor and attitude. The first time Pharisees mentioned in the Bible, Jesus was accusing them of stuff, you know. They were wrong. Now, they were good people. They were morally correct, and I'm sure you're a moral person. You try to, you know, treat your wife right and your kids right, but that has nothing to do with your doctrine. And if I come across as mean-spirited or whatever, and I don't want to do that, but if I am, that still would have nothing to do with doctrine. Elijah and the prophets of Baal, I mean, he killed them.
Yeah, but don't you understand how offensive it is for you to call into question my credentials as an astrophysicist?
I'm not calling you credentials. I'm saying what you're teaching is contrary to this book.
Wait, who says that?
I say that.
Okay, but the fact is there are people that are other Christians that disagree with you on that passage.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure there are.
And so the fact is that you can't, that's where if we're going to say that is the thing where we divide people who are Christian and non-Christian, mm-hmm. then 1 Corinthians 15 goes out the tubes, because this is the gospel that I preached to you by which you believe, you receive,
right.
and by you're saved. You either accept that or you're lost. And that has to do that Jesus died for our sins according to the scripture. He was put into the grave. He arose again. I think that there are certain things inside the church that we can disagree on and still be believers.
Sure.
So I think that this is where we got to drop that word cult.
Well, when I see the teaching. When I see him teaching, it's a local flood in the days of Noah, and God designed a world with suffering and death and cruelty, and that's just not the same God.
I hear you. The fact is, at that point, guys like Waalkie and Gleason Archer disagree with him as well, but it's a disagreement inside the circle. And what I'm saying is, if we're going to have a discussion inside the church on these questions...
And we should. This is fine.
Okay. I think that we just need to go on from there.
Well, let me define cult. A cult is where you need a particular leader to tell you what the book says. That's what Hugh Ross is doing.
Yeah, but the fact is we can't say that that's true about Genesis 1 and 2, because there's a whole lot of passages that I need help on throughout the Bible, just Genesis 1 and 2.
Let's do a survey. Let's get 5,000 people that have never heard of this argument. Let's hand them this book and say, what does this say?
Hey, listen, on 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, the fact is you can get 1,000 Christians together, and we've already got about 1,000 different opinions.
Sure.
And I'm simply saying that God's got one right way. We know that, and the fact is we're going to figure that out. But I'm saying to have this discussion now, you don't have the end story, and neither does Hugh. There's assumptions that both of you are making, young earth people and old earth people are both making.
Right.
We're to test those.
Sure.
And if the scripture does give us leeway to open up our thinking, then I think we've got to go that direction.
You know, the thing I long for is where we can test this disagreement in front of an audience of Bible scholars and research scientists, Christians as well as non-Christians. When you test it in front of an audience where everybody is credentialed in the field, then you can really figure out what's going on, what's bogus, what's invalid, what's on target.
And maybe we can do that sometime.
Well, I would disagree with that too. If you tested communism and capitalism in front of an audience of Soviet scientists, you know, a person who spent 50 years living in America is going to be heavily indoctrinated by evolution
but
teaching.
But you just defined the parameters on that one. The fact is, would there be a crowd then that we could do that with evangelical scholars?
Everybody's biased.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I'm saying, therefore, our advice to the Christians is they've got to examine the text. Each of you have a point of view on this, and they've
sure.
got to in look at it. Let's ask the next question
okay.
here.
This is to Hugh Ross. I was wondering, do you think your theory of creation should be taught in schools, and if so, how? And I think, you know, the truth of our origin is one of the most important things that in the U.S. right now, because lots of people are being led away by the teaching of evolution.
No, I would strongly argue that we must teach this in the public education arena. In fact, we've noticed that reasons to believe that our speakers have a wide open door into the public schools, secular universities. Professors are asking us to come into their classrooms. And the whole point is you cannot divorce science and theology. They overlap. There's no significant scientific statement I can think of that doesn't have theological overtones. The whole point, though, is to go into the public school classroom with a demeanor, I'm not going to jam this down your throat. We're going to lay out the facts. We're going to open up the field for discussion and question. We're not going to call into question what the textbooks are teaching. We're just simply giving you a different perspective, a different interpretation on the established facts of nature. Where you get closed doors is when you call into question the established facts of nature. If you don't call it into question, if you don't try to jam the gospel down people's throats, the doors are wide open. And the thing I've noticed is this. If you go into the public school classroom without that pressure motive, the students and professors will ask you how to become a Christian. First time I ever gave a lecture in a public high school is Arcadia High School. The leading atheist in the class after it was all over said, "Well, Dr. Ross, if all this is true, what must I do to avoid judgment?" I gave the gospel. He prayed to receive Christ. 10 minutes later, he led two of his atheist friends to Christ. We have the public right to do that in a public school classroom. I mean, the separation of church and state in no way forbids that kind of activity going on. And I find that even atheist professors are really open to the idea of speakers coming in as long as they don't come in with a dogma.
I guess I would have to preface that question. I'm of a strong, even having taught science 15 years, we shouldn't even have public schools according to the Constitution. If we're going to have them, then who should control them and who decides what's taught? You cannot discuss origins without getting into religious implications. Evolution, young earth creation, old earth creation, doesn't matter. If you're talking about origins, education in general is a religious. You know, you have to impart religion is tied in with education. And there's no such thing as separation of church and state. The Constitution never mentions that. That's in a letter that a Baptist pastor wrote, or Jefferson wrote to a Baptist pastor in 1802. So the Constitution says the state cannot establish a religion. And I think we've done that with evolution. I speak in public schools all the time. I get in lots of public schools and teach young earth creationism. I teach on dinosaurs. I say, kids, dinosaurs have always lived with man. They did not live millions of years ago. People called them dragons, and they killed them for years, for centuries. They were killed by man. They're mentioned in the Bible as dragons. They're mentioned all through history. There might be a few still alive, and I go into some of the cryptozoology stuff. So I get in lots of public schools, and we win thousands to the Lord. So I think schools are open to this, and a lot of teachers are scared to talk about this, and they don't need to be. We've got a whole videotape just on what can be done in the public school.
Question.
Yes, Hugh Ross, how would God communicate in a clear way, if it was his intent to do so, that he created the earth in 6 calendar days?
Okay.
Contrast that with modify Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 through 11, to satisfy that.
Yeah, you'd have to change the wording of all 10 creation texts in the Bible to fit that point of view. You'd also have to change the astrophysical record. You're looking at a radically different Bible as well as a radically different record of nature. If I were to see that, I would be persuaded.
How would you change the text?
How would I change the text? Well, for one thing, you would have to take away that omission of the evening and morning phrase for the seventh day. I would expect to see closure in the Bible on the seventh day rather than the extension of the seventh day.
Let's slow that one down because I don't think that's come up before. There's something different in the wording on the seventh day.
Sure.
That is, you're saying, a clue to how you interpret the other periods of time, morning and evening. What is that seventh day? What's different about that?
Well, I just finished writing a book with five other scholars called The Genesis Debate, Framework Hypothesis, Young Earth, and Day Age. And what's fascinating to me is we took very different positions on the Sabbath. The framework people view that the seventh day is eternal. The young earth creationists said it's 24 hours. We took the point of view that it was a long but finite period of time that ends with the beginning of the new creation.
Why? Tell us why.
Okay, the text. And this is where we were making progress in the debate. The editor was quite pleased because he says, there's a lot more clarity in the scripture on the length of the seventh day than there is in these other
issues. Paraphrase the text because our folks need to be brought up to speed what you're talking
okay.
about.
Okay, Genesis 1, we have closure on the first 6 days. There's an evening and the morning for day 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Seventh day, that's missing. It's not closed. There's no evening and morning for the seventh day. You read in Psalm 95 and Hebrews 4 that we're still in the seventh day. The seventh day continues through the future. You get into Revelation 21, God creates again. That's the eighth day. And what I noted as a 16-year-old looking at all this stuff is that when you look at the fossil record, a huge amount of evidence for speciation before Adam at a rate of one new animal species a year. Since Adam, the speciation rate measures zero. As Jesus said in John chapter 5, God has indeed ceased performing his creation miracles. He continues to form other miracles, but God is now in a state of ceasing creation miracles. That's the seventh day.
Kent?
Well, again, I would say if you can't read Exodus 20:11, and this is the only thing that we're aware of except when Jesus wrote on the ground, God wrote this one on a rock with his own finger. He said to the Hebrew people, I want you to rest on the seventh for in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Here we have a case where God is clearly putting over, anybody can understand it, these 7 days are all the same. I think it is true that, we enter into the rest of Christ, which lasts forever, thankfully for that. But that just because there's the rest of God is eternal doesn't mean that seventh day was eternal. You have the type, the Bible says Satan is like a roaring lion. Well, there really are roaring lions. You have to have an example to compare it with. The Bible says he's like a serpent, and there really are serpents. And it says God's rest was the eternal, but there really was a day of rest. The Jews were not commanded to go out and work 6 million years and rest a million, or to work 6 days and then rest a million. Otherwise, they'd have worked 6 days and been done. They'd still be resting. It just simply doesn't make sense. All through Scripture, you see him refer to the seventh day, Exodus chapter 31. God said, it is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested.
These passages aren't as clear as you claim. The preposition is not in the original, neither Exodus 31 or Exodus 20. There are three other passages in the Levitical law that also reflect this statement. And you've got Leviticus 25 referring to the agricultural land. I mean, you can read the Bible scholar literature on this. It's not as clear cut as you claim.
Well, what you're saying is that in that terms of the Leviticus passage concerning harvest, it talks about in the day of harvest. Walkie and Archer would say you don't have harvest in one 24-hour period of time. It may be in the fall, it may be in the spring, whatever the climate and so on. So I think that's what you're saying, isn't it right?
No, I'm referring to Leviticus 25, which states that the land is to be worked for 6 1-hour periods and given a Sabbath rest of 1 year. So there's an example in Scripture where you got a different Sabbath period than 24 hours.
The other thing is that in the Exodus passages, you also have the Feast of Tabernacles. You also have the commemoration going back to the days of wandering in the wilderness. And the time that is set for the celebration or the commemoration is not the same as what they went through. Doesn't that seem to open up the door that the same thing is going on in terms of the Sabbath rest?
Well, there are several different Sabbaths the Bible talks about. There was the six-day week and the seventh day of rest. There was the 6 years of plowing the field and the seventh year of rest. And then there's the year of Jubilee, the seven sevens. You put it all together, and on the 50th year you rest. But that has nothing to do with the creation week. The fact is, it was a six-day creation and a seventh day of rest. How he applies that to the creation week blows my mind. I mean, just read the text. It's talking about 6 days of work and a seventh day of rest.
But there's a tenth verse between verse 9 and 11 that you've dropped out.
Oh, really?
Verse 9 is referring to, you know, the rest period of human beings. Verse 11 to the rest period of God. There's nothing in the text that says that there's an exact equation between the context of verse 9 and verse 11. You know, God works six periods. He rests on the seventh period. We work six periods. We rest in the seventh period. As Paul points out in Romans 14, the critical principle is one of six and one. It doesn't matter when we celebrate the Sabbath. What matters is that we do take one day out of seven as a Sabbath period of rest.
Well, let me read it to you because I don't want to be accused of leaving something out.
I'll start in verse 8.
Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work. Thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord hallowed, or blessed, the seventh day, and hallowed it. Then it goes on to the next commandment, honor your father and mother. This passage couldn't be more clear. This is six normal days and a seventh day of rest.
Okay, you know the preposition's not there in the original in verse 11.
Here we go,
11.
Where we have to have you to tell us what this says again.
Wait.
Look it up in an interlinear.
Well, the fact is, the argument that yam never means anything else in the Hebrew Bible but a literal 24 hours is completely untenable in the light of scriptural usage elsewhere. That's by our two leading evangelical scholars.
I have never said that yam always means a 24-hour day. When it's put with the modifiers, evening, morning, the first day, the second day, then it always means a 24-hour day. So what passage of Scripture, Hugh, do you have where it uses evening and morning? I mean, Jesus was in the grave for 3 days. How long was he in the grave?
Okay, in the book of Daniel, we have numbered days that are not 24 hours. Pardon me, with evenings and mornings. In the book of Hosea, we've got number days.
Explain that one. What's the one in Daniel you're talking about here?
I think it's chapter 10. Okay, but you can check our website. We've got an article written by one of our scholars on what Daniel says about the evenings and mornings. We also have a piece on Hosea chapter 6.
You're talking about the prophecy of Daniel where he's talking about in the end times about the...
How the Israelites will be without a king for 1 day and 2 days, and the third day they would have their king. And most Bible scholars believe it's referring to that time period when Israel, the land of Israel, is without a Jewish king. And indeed, we know that for 2,000 years of human history, the land has been without a king.
All right, we got a question here.
In comparison, I have a real easy question. Does the Bible teach that there was a time that the earth was packed in ice, or the ice age theory? And if so, did it occur in chapter 1 of Genesis between verses 1 and 2?
Yeah, the only passages I'm aware of are in the books of the Psalms and the Proverbs. There's one in Job as well, which makes the point that God controls the quantity of snow, frost, and ice for the benefit of all life. And, as a physicist, I can tell you that you do need this regular cycling of water through all three states. What makes life possible on planet Earth is not just that we got liquid water, but that we have a huge quantity of frozen water, liquid water, and water vapor, and you need these to be cycling in order for particularly advanced life to be possible on planet Earth. So that's the most direct reference I could find in the Bible for an ice age, but I wouldn't say it's proof of an ice age. It's simply proof that there are these large quantities of frozen water that do cycle through our environment.
Right. I don't think I would disagree with what he said there. That still would have nothing to do with when this happened. I think you'll find most young Earth creationists would fall into two camps of what the ice age. Some would say, like I happen to be in the camp, that the ice age was probably what caused the flood. Others would say the flood caused the ice age. You know, minor difference, but we've got a whole videotape, we call it the Hovind theory, so nobody else gets blamed for it, about how the ice age probably was caused by a meteor strike.
More questions and that's it for tonight.
Okay. Dr. Hovind, you've talked several times tonight about the Bible and the fact that the only correct interpretation of Genesis in your mind is that which a simple person or a person with no exposure to the Bible would come up with if you gave them the Bible to read.
I wouldn't say that. Don't put that word in my mouth. If you gave this book to 5,000 people who didn't care about the argument, they would all come back and say, it says 6 days. That's okay. The obvious reading of the text. That's my point.
Okay. But one of the great things about the Bible is that you have a simple statement, like a teaching by Jesus, a parable, let's say. And you look at a simple statement, and a child can understand that and get something profound out of that. Mm-hmm. But yet, as you grow in maturity and knowledge, you find that there's different levels of understanding. There's a depth of truth in Scripture. Wouldn't you say it's possible that what Dr. Ross is doing, what other scientists are doing, is using their God-given abilities and the knowledge that's increasing now to unpack Genesis 1 and 2 and go beyond the simple God created, which sufficed for many people for many years, to an understanding of how God created?
Well, I think you've got a faulty analogy here. A 5-year-old can look at a TV and understand what he sees. As a person grows, there are different levels of understanding. An electronics engineer looks at a TV and sees it very differently. He sees, wow, look at the magnetic field being deflected, you know, the dot being deflected all over the screen and how many lines are on the screen. Different people can look at the same thing. None of them are wrong. One has more understanding. But to say that the 5-year-old reads Genesis and says, wow, he did it in 6 days, and then later he finds out his initial interpretation was wrong, that's not what happens.
Well, let me put it in a different context. You read Genesis 1 and it says 6 days. I agree with that.
Okay.
Okay, that's the simple reading of the text. Now you decide to go back to the text and say, I'm going to dig a little bit deeper and see exactly what these 6 days are. And can't you do that with every passage of the Bible? There's an immediate context you can pull out of the text that doesn't take very deep study, but I would argue every chapter of the Bible, you can return to it and learn a whole lot more you never picked up the first time.
Yeah, but see, you got a faulty analogy also, because you're saying as you get deeper, you now have an interpretation that is contrary to your initial interpretation.
Not at all.
Yeah, that's what you just said.
Because
I'm saying you get deeper
into 6 long periods of time are totally consistent. There's no contradiction.
Well, see, the problem is that quickly leads into death before sin, a local flood, and some of the other things that you teach that are just simply not true, not scriptural. And
that's your opinion.
Well, right, yes,
and
no.
All right, let's pick it up here. Hold on.
For days 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, it has that evening and morning phrase. This is for Dr. Ross. Why would they even have to mention evening and morning? And why couldn't they just say it was the first and it was the first day, it was the second day? What could evening possibly mean? I know there's different meanings for day, but what about evening?
Well, I made reference to this paper by our theologian friend Paul Elbert, who analyzes very thing about evenings and mornings. And, you know, he makes the point, and I've made it myself, that just like the Hebrew word yom has got 3 different literal definitions, likewise the Hebrew words translated evening and morning have multiple literal definitions. And his point is that this is a reference to the fact that these first 6 days have a beginning, they have an ending. The 7th day has got a beginning, but doesn't yet have an ending. That's what's being communicated in the text. And hey, if you subscribe to our Facts for Faith magazine, you will see this future article by Paul Elbert.
I guess I would stick with what I've said so far. The obviously, the 7th day is the same as the other days because it's lumped all together with them in Exodus 20 and in Exodus 31. And there isn't, I mean, the whole idea of you work 6 days and then you rest from then on, who wouldn't want a job like that? I'd like one of those jobs. I mean, that's just simply not the way it is. There's a seven-day week. And the seventh day does, this, the original day has a close. Now, the rest of God does not have a close. But I'm not God.
Well, I would argue that the seventh day of God will close in the future. When he conquers evil, then we're going to see the eighth creation day. God's going to create again. Brand new creation. Radically different physics, radically different dimensionality. God will cease his rest. So just like his rest period comes to an end, so does our rest period come to an end. But I think what you're trying to do is go beyond the point that it's six work periods and one rest period. In fact, our pastor has argued that we shouldn't be taking Saturday and Sunday off. We should only get one day off per week because the scriptures say you're supposed to work 6 days. But I would argue, who of us doesn't work when we're home Saturday or Sunday?
All right, guys, I just want to say thank you for all that you've shared with us. And my hope is that those of you that are watching, that you will let this material be that which will motivate you to dig into the scripture. And hopefully it's turned on the lights in your mind as to the relationship of scripture and science, and that this will increase your faith in the God of the Bible. So guys, again, I want to say thank you for being here and for all that you've done and for those of you that have listened.
You're welcome.